everyone that made it out tonight. It's always my staff that's the last one to shut up, but that's okay. So who is here for the first time to a One Stop Ready program? All right, welcome. We are very, very happy to have you. Who won't admit that they're here for a first time? No, I'm just teasing. For the veterans that are here, and we've got some good veterans in the crowd, this program now is in its fifth year. Is that right, Brett? 5 years of this?
Four years.
It feels like five, right? So 4 years. We have wonderful communities in Oakland County that have joined, but we have three and maybe four communities that are going to join this year. So if you're from Orchard Lake.
Hey, Matt.
Yes.
I was wrong. You were right. 5 years.
5 years. That's what I'm saying. Orchard Lake. I see my friends from Orchard Lake. And I see my friends from Farmington Hills.
One.
One.
Represent.
All right. Well, Calfani Stevens, he's in trouble now. And Madison Heights, of course. I see Madison Heights, friends of mine. From all of our other communities, we certainly want to welcome you. We have now 23 One Stop Ready communities throughout the county. And hard to see the different logos, but assuredly, they're from all different parts of the county. They're villages and townships and cities, some that are doing dynamically positive things, and probably say, I don't really need this program, but have graciously admitted that you can always be learning something new. And if you don't tell yourself that you're going to learn something new and make yourself better, then you're probably not a good candidate for this program, because this program, that's what it's about. It's about self-evaluation. It's about looking at how you do things, acknowledging the really good things that you do, recognizing the things that you can improve on, and understanding, most importantly, who you are as a community. How are you perceived? What are you trying to accomplish? Every community is a little different. Our three new communities, Orchard Lake and Madison Heights, probably couldn't be two different communities, right? But they still have the same responsibility to their citizens of having an understanding of who you are, how you're trying to sustain yourself long-term, how you represent yourself to the public and what you're doing. So every community is a little bit different, and we welcome everybody. All right, so first, the good news. Let me tell a little bit about, before I get into the numbers, about how, for the new people, how this applies to the mentality of what we try to do in One Stop Ready. So my good friends from Oxford said, you know, one of the challenges is that a lot of people think One Stop Ready is, let's teach you how to break the rules. So for my veterans, have we ever said anything about going around your ordinance or not imposing restrictions and not allowing, you know, have we ever said anything like that, Gary? Have we ever said anything like
only
that?
Only once.
Oh, one time. It's not about that. This program is not about going around the rules. It is about what the placard says. It's about being reliable, responsible, resourceful, self-evaluation. It's also an understanding of times are good right now. And when times are good, you might not think that we have to worry about permitting process or that we have to worry about, where are we going to find the next deal? Because the deals have been pretty plentiful. In the next 30 days in Oakland County, we're going to be announcing close to $1 billion of new investment in the county. That's a lot. That's a lot of investment, right? It is huge, right? So it comes from a variety of sources, some very big deals and some very small deals, but all of it collectively represents an investment. So why would we care? Well, we do care, and here's why. So where are we at? The unemployment rate, the lowest level since 2000. So we're at about 3% unemployment right now, which is great. Our economic outlook, there's some copies of it out here for you. It's great news, right? People that live in Orchard Lake are working. Businesses in Madison Heights that are tool and die and that tier two manufacturing, they're full. Places up in Oxford, they got new restaurants. What's it called again? It's called?
Homegrown.
Homegrown's supposed to be a great new restaurant up in Oxford. Everything's cooking, right? The economic outlook says that Oakland County now is at cruising altitude. And when we get this done, we spend $35,000 of our taxpayer money, and it's my taxpayer money too, to hire University of Michigan. And we've done how many years? Does it say?
32.
32 years. 32 years, we hire the best at University of Michigan to say, where are we at? What are we doing? They're predicting in the next 3 years, we will add 45 to 50,000 new jobs to Oakland County. To an unemployment rate that's already at 3%, and to a labor force that is approaching 2001 levels, which means if we add all those jobs, we will have the highest employed labor force in the history of Oakland County. So why do we need One Stop Ready? It sounds like everything is just rosy. I almost swore. Jane will catch me if I swear. So for my newcomers, I apologize. I don't swear a lot, but sometimes I say damn or hell. So just, I apologize for that, all right? Because I get excited about this stuff. So it's good, right? Recorded job growth from 09 to 16, 18% job growth. Michigan was around 12 and the national was 10. Projected job growth going forward, it's just as amazing. Oakland County's unemployment rate fell, but has recovered faster than any of the states. But look what's there. Looks like a big hole in the ground, doesn't it? Looks like I stuck my spade down there, and look, oh, Michigan does the same thing. Well, you guys are good with the graphics this time. That's pretty cool. That's good. So we've got a big hole. So back in 2000, well, this number, well, shoot, that looks like about the same as that number. So are we any better off than we were in 2000? Not really. We're not any better off. Look at the job loss we had, and look at the economic context of it. So who, if they could go and lead their community, would say to their constituents, who's an elected leader in the room? I know, Mary, you're an elected leader, right? So could you go to your constituents the week before the election and say, my platform is, I would like the city of the village of Orchard Lake. That's your long title, right? The city of the village of Orchard Lake. I would like us to only be as good as we were in 2001 and never any better than that. And my platform is, we're going to stay the status quo from 2001. Would that be a good campaign platform? Not really, right? Every community, no matter how much they want to preserve the tradition of who they are, wants to have new and sustainable things. They want to have growth. And so we look at the numbers and say, man, we are kicking tail straight. All we've done is fill the hole. That's all we've done. If you look at the types of jobs that are coming in, look at these jobs, all industry jobs. These are great numbers. And look at this, high wage industry jobs, $75,000 or more, middle wage. The top jobs, or the job growth, is not coming from service jobs. It's coming from what we call the knowledge-based economy. So what does that mean for your community? Does it mean that smart people are living here? Yeah. As the governor said last week, we were in Europe for a week working on economic development, and one of his favorite lines was, we are now leading the Great Lakes states in inbound bachelor's degrees. And you can picture the governor saying that with that squeaky University of Michigan voice has. But it's kind of cool. Now, we haven't led with inbound anything in like 20 years. So the fact that we're building a knowledge-based economy is all within the context of not only good news, but what you have to start thinking about your state of readiness to have long-term sustainability for your community. You have an understanding of the type of economy that's there. You have an understanding of the type of jobs that are coming. So not just jobs from new businesses that would grow, but it's the type of jobs that would be buying houses within your community. The type of jobs that would say, I'm going to tear down an old house and build a new house. All of that is economic sustainability within your communities. And so the numbers are really, really good. And challenges remain, all right? I love this chart, we use it every time. 2009, we lost 60,000 jobs. And it reinforces the point that we are just now climbing above where we used to be years and years and years ago. But here's the other challenge that looms ahead. So who's lived in Michigan for more than 20 years? When have we ever had, count the upward lines. Even Gary Wall can count that high, 9 upward lines. When have we ever had more than a 9-year sustained economic recovery in the state of Michigan? So what will happen here in your community? We get to 2019, and say we hit the numbers, and we hit that highest job rate ever in Oakland County. Where are we at here? Do you think it'll continue? It could. I know Pontiac thinks it will because they're so darn busy right now. Will it continue? What is the challenge that lies ahead? How deep was the hole that we were in? And have we prepared ourselves for sustainability long term as a community and as a county going forward? So Dan Hunter usually uses this slide when he talks about the economic context. And we love it to say, here's the big thing. We could summarize this complex chart in one way. In the downturn, Oakland County lost 36% of what we're worth. We lost a third of our value. Excuse me. It's a lot. You think we've climbed out of that yet? So what prevents your community from climbing out? We love Prop A and Hidley when it's going down. Community tax base when it's coming back up. Unless we get new investment, unless you get new investment in your community, then you're capped. And the ability to climb out of your hole, even though your budgets are probably doing pretty well right now, in a longer term sustainability, it will get compromised, and we at the county really recognize that. Okay, is this you?
The difference in 1 year in that gap, when we were doing this last year, it was $56 million. So we gained $8 million. With all the stuff that's going on around Oakland County, that gap only reduced by $8 million.
So that's the county value, county tax gap, right?
Yeah.
Good point. So put that in context to your community. Our team last year did $900 million?
$900 million.
Just our team did $900 million in investment in Oakland County. We changed our gap by $8 million. $900 million. Jay?
You know, you asked the question, what do we have to do? From what I can see, at least for us in Pontiac, we have a lot of catching up to do. Our roads have not been maintained as well because of the economy for us. Plus, we are getting some of these smart people that we're talking, and we have to find housing. And we have to find ways to entertain them. So, and the education as well has to be there. So we still have a ways to go. Long ways to go.
I didn't set her up for that. I didn't really set you up for that, John.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, I didn't really set you up for that.
It's good to see it. I'm not too far off. But we do. We still have a long ways to go.
So for the newcomers, for the veterans, and particularly my staff, forgive me, I'm going to tell the Taco Bell story again. Glenn served the Taco Bell. If you want to know if you're a newcomer to this program, why did we come up with this? Yeah, these economic numbers are great. Do they apply to Orchard Lake? Maybe not. You guys are pretty stable, but they apply, right? Thinking about the mentality of, they certainly apply to Pontiac and the urgency of it all. You know, One Stop Ready is a program that does take this into account, and it stems from the idea of asking the right questions, of having a knowledge of what you're looking at or doing as a community for your economic sustainability. So, Rick, is this about saying yes?
Absolutely.
It's about saying yes to everything?
No.
Is it about saying no? This program is about knowing when to say yes and when to say no, and the timing between the two, and having it within the context of what Pontiac's going through. Now, Pontiac is a success story like nothing else right now. We're about to announce fairly soon hundreds of millions of dollars in Pontiac favor. It's great stuff. It's great for Orchard Lake. It's great for Madison Heights. The Tier 2s that will support that big factory that's going in are going to come out of Madison Heights. The executives and the knowledge-based economy are going to buy houses in Orchard Lake. All of this kind of intertwines. And so you're looking at the context of this and you say, are we asking the right questions? And what's the reactive capacity to we ask the right questions? So when I was supervisor in Marion Township, in 2009, we saved the GM plant, which was a big accomplishment for us. That right now has a residual impact of about 17,000 net jobs in the region because we kept that plant alive. By keeping the plant alive, we kept Pontiac Stamping alive. So with Pontiac Stamping has a net impact of about 20,000 net jobs within the region. We were given a deadline of about 6 weeks to figure that out. So we went from a notice that says the plant's gonna close to some God-sent miracle that they said they're negotiating a contract that'll bring one plant back to life in North America, and you're on the list. We said, well, what do we have to do? Make a better business case than Janesville, Wisconsin, and Spring Hill, Tennessee. Would your community be ready to do that? Even though you might not have a GM factory in your communities, would you be ready to do that? Would you have the willpower in your community to do it? Do you have the tools at hand? I mean, are you knowledgeable enough about what would go into something like that to be able to do it in 6 weeks, to get it through your council and your boards and all those things? So we did it, and it was a great success story for Michigan. But the end of the story is this. About 6 months later, somebody wanted to build a Taco Bell restaurant at I-75 in Baldwin Road. So everybody knows where Great Lakes Crossing is, all right? Across the street, across the freeway, is what Auburn Hills calls the Golden Mile. It's where there's Best Buy and Staples and Costco and Myers and Target and Joann Fett's. It's as much big box retail as you could ever imagine in your life. On the other side of the road, Orient Township, where I live, I was supervisor for a short time, they believe heartily that that should be research and development. And it is still today gravel pits and garbage. I mean, it still wants to be researched and developed. Now, at the end of that stretch, at Baldwin I-75, they wanted to put in what Del Taco, which is a small competitor to Taco Bell. They chased it out of town. How dare you bring in that type of restaurant to that intersection? Because there's houses there. It didn't matter that it was zoned general business 2 with a highway asterisk on the bottom. There's houses there. How can we do that to those residents? They live there. So I became supervisor. We saved the plant. Nothing was really happening other than that. So I called my old client, Yum Brands, and I said, would you put a Taco Bell there? And they said, we'd love that site. It might be our number one performing site if we could build that restaurant. So I said, well, you can't come in just yet. Because I needed to make us one step ready, because I knew it would never survive the Planning Commission and the Zoning Board the way our ordinance was set up. So we fixed a bunch of stuff, except for one variance. And the variance that they needed was a setback variance for the little squawk box. So when people pull up, you can't have too much noise, right? You know, God forbid. And they wanted it so that that squawk box was 50 feet from the property line. I tried to get it so it'd be like 15 feet. So they knew I was doing up to something. So 50 feet, it used to be 100 feet. Can you imagine that? A setback for a squawk box and a drive-through, 100 feet from your property line. So how prohibitive is that? It's super prohibitive, right? So we switched it to 50, so they need one variance. There was one house in that neighborhood that came and complained at the zoning board. Nobody else came, but one place came. Nice family, they don't like me very much, but they're a nice family. And they complained that we're gonna have to look at this, to which my response would have been, well, move. Now that's a harsh response, right? As community leaders, you don't ever look somebody in the eye and say, well, just move. But you have to recognize that it's I-75 in Baldwin. It's about 100 yards north of the interchange. It's zoned highway commercial. I don't want to look at it. So here's what the ZBA did. We're going to screen it. Ask the Yum Brands guy, will you plant 20, 25 foot tall evergreen on the corner of this property so they don't have to look at you? And much to their surprise, Yum Brands said, we will. So here's the one stop ready lesson, and then we're going to follow through this, and Dan, you can talk about the program. The Zoning Board of Appeals said, if you'll do that, we're going to move this forward. And the Yum Brands official said, but here's the deal for us. We'll do that, but you need to make it a condition of your approval tonight if you're inclined to approve our variance. One variance. As soon as they said that, one member of the zoning board said, we don't like to get pushed around by greedy developers, particularly ones that are from out of state. And so I'm going to table this for 60 days, and you're going to prove that it's going to be on the plan because I don't trust that you're going to do this.
Is he still alive?
Yeah, well, Gary knows me well because the paint peeled after that, right? He tabled it for 60 days. So there is a Taco Bell restaurant as we fixed all of that. And here's some commentary tonight about some of the methodology of how we fixed that and how we made ourselves an Orion one-stop ready before we really knew what the concept was. But here's the one-stop ready concept and what we want you to start believing, particularly our new communities. Those that are really good at this, those that are still learning about this, or trying to figure out how it applies to you. What the guy didn't ask was the right question. He could table it for 60 days as long as he was operating on the correct information. He didn't say, is this a corporate franchise opportunity or is this cell phone? If the answer is it's a corporate franchise opportunity and the timing of when it was, the next question is, when are your corporate meetings that are going to set the schedule for construction for the next 12 months? He didn't ask those questions. He didn't say, is this property subject to a like-kind exchange? Knowing that the clock ticks on like-kind exchange because you have people that will sell property with the idea they're going to flip that into a like-kind exchange to avoid tax liability as they further develop property. All of those have clocks that tick on them. They didn't ask questions like that. So is it incumbent on you to ask those questions? Sure it is. You can be loud, Susan. Be boisterous.
Yes.
All right. It is incumbent on you to ask questions. Do you have to know every question? Sean, do you have to know every question?
No.
You don't have to know
every
question.
You're here.
Yeah. Right. Believe me, I don't know it all either. But you have to be sensible enough to be able to say, time out. We're a one-stop ready community. I don't want to be perceived that I have completely destroyed something without being knowledgeable about it. And at least raise the question, is there something we should be asking? Because other people on that zoning board, and I appointed them, they knew to ask those questions and they didn't ask it either. What happened was, the next morning, I got a fax. Remember fax, Emily? So if you come through the fax. It wasn't that long ago, 2008, 2009, that wasn't that long ago. That said, we have to cancel the deal because we're going to committee in 2 days. And we can't take a 60-day delay, even if they do approve us, because it's 2009. And how on earth are we ever gonna delay this? So by demanding a plan with the trees on it, instead of just doing a conditional approval, and making the delay happen, we lost a deal. Now this is what it gets back to this. The long-winded story gets back to the economic context. How big is the hole? Dan, were you gonna talk about this one?
No,
this is me?
He didn't have to.
All right, we'll talk about this in a second. How big is the hole? So what did I lose? Linda, what did I lose when I lost to Taco Bell? What did I lose as a community?
New jobs, new investment, new tax base.
Revenue.
Taxes.
Did I lose the trees to stream the curmudgeon on top of the hill that didn't want to look at it? No, I still got the trees. Did I lose the curmudgeon that complains at every meeting now to the hereafter? No, I still got the curmudgeon out there. They never seem to go away.
Well, your reputation.
I didn't lose that. Did I lose reputation? I lost a little reputation. Sure. The development community says, well, that's how you're going to be. Why would I come invest in your community? So what did I lose? I lost jobs and investments. So in Orient Township, like everybody else, we shrunk our budget by 40% in 2009 and 10. We shrunk our sheriff's protection. We're under Oakland County Sheriff. We had to lay off 6 officers. We didn't lay them off. We just said we can't afford it anymore. We had to consolidate our parks and community recreation departments, and we laid off 40% of the staff over an 11-month period in Orient Township. So when they said, I want 25 trees and we're going to table it for 60 days, what did I really lose? I lost about $62,000 of annual revenue into my budget. And I lost about 70 jobs, 50 of which would be employed by high school kids in that community. One Stop Ready is not about saying, please approve this project. It's not about that at all. It's about having an understanding of what the economic context of what you're doing to sustain your community. It's about asking who you are. So Gary, when we asked your community to offer who you are, what did you guys say at first? You remember that quote? Right. Gary, he didn't say it because it was Marie Hauser that said it. They told me we're the best neighborhood in Oakland County. So who disputes that Waterford is the best neighborhood in Oakland County? I get that. Prove it. So my response was, are you being the best neighborhood in Oakland County? Oxford told me. I said, why do they choose Oxford? Because we got a cute downtown. That was the first answer. So they choose you because you got a cute downtown.
Well, that's a good one.
That's a great economic strategy. They don't choose you because it's a cute downtown. It was not you. They choose you because you have a perceptive understanding of how to treat people in a way that accelerates their investment and preserves the identity of who you are. Plain and simple. Madison Heights is a shining example of it. They're a community much like Auburn Hills. Totally gets it. They have administrative approval for everything. How many planning commissions do you have? Four?
Four meetings.
They have 4 planning commission meetings a year.
It's required by law.
It's only required by law. They approve everything administratively. That's their model. Auburn Hills, other model. They have planning commission meetings once a week almost. It's a different type of model. They understand who they are.
And why do they have to do it?
Here's what's on the horizon in the economic context. So without giving away that one of our announcements has to do with this site, it's completely coincidental.
It's not great. This is
not. The Michigan Motion Picture Studio site. The map doesn't really give it justice to where it is, but if you're familiar with the movie studio on Updike and South Boulevard, pretend that's in your community. What do you do with it? What do you do with it? I don't know what you do with it. I mean, how do you undo it? So this is part of a Renaissance zone. Everybody know what a Renaissance zone is? You know what a Renaissance zone is? Basically, you don't pay taxes. So from a community standpoint, you've got to get a payment in lieu of taxes to generate any revenue out of the site. Those two things right there, for most planning commissioners, you have just exhausted their knowledge of how they want to engage. And that's not a detriment to planning commissioners. There's some in the audience today. So we've got those factors. You've got big concrete block buildings that have no real accessibility for heavy traffic because they were movie studios. They weren't designed for heavy truck traffic. There's no loading bays, there's no nothing on the site. This is a big office building on this side that is a little bit dated. And you think, well, fill the office building up, but we've got 1.1 million square feet of office on this side that's only about a third full right now. So it's not like exactly a hotbed of attractiveness. There's very limited parking. You see, there's like very limited parking. This really isn't even parking here. This is the old truck and bus factory site, so we can't really use that. So we point this out because of the complexity of what we're facing and the value of what it means. So we figured out how to use the site, and we're about to announce something that we're sworn to non-disclosure, but it's a big investment. It's close to $400 million investment on the site. This is what it means to us in revenue. $4.4 million for one project. So, in total revenue. We don't have to go back to it, but remember the hole that we're still in? Mm-hmm. Who remembers the number? 48. So now I'm at 44. I still need $44 million to go to get back to 2003.
11 more of those.
Isn't that great? 11 more of those, right? The economic context of what you're doing. This is the cash that goes into our budget at the end of the day. We were doing a $400 million deal, and at the end of the day, $4 million goes towards our value. This is the cash position that goes into the county budget by doing a $400 million deal in Oakland County. How many people could you employ? What's that?
Need 120 of those.
Need 120 of those, right?
He's better at math than Gary Wall.
All right, so we say all of this because we want to get you thinking in one step ready. And Dan's going to take over now. I'm sure to talk some more, as I always do, to get you thinking about the context of what it means to be one stop ready. It's not about, I'm going to approve this, and I'm not going to approve that. It's not about, we need to preserve, you know, the house on the hill by planting 25 trees. It's not about any of that. It's about educating yourselves that you all have a role to play in pursuing the economic vision of your community in a way that gives you the answer to this context. Say one more thing that you're going to do. So the governor and I are just in Europe. There's a company that is completely ready to come to Oakland County and expand. They do probiotic bacteria. So everybody that eats yogurt and probiotics and all that kind of stuff, there's companies that make that bacteria, and they know that they've got to do it in the Midwest, and so they want to do it in Michigan. Here's the cash. It's about a $50 million investment. That'll employ only about 50 people, but the average wage is about $160,000 US per employee. I'd like to have that in my community. Buy some nice houses there in Orchard Lake, right? Here's the catch. They need to be operational by March. They want a new construction. Who could do it? Madison Heights could do it. Orchard Lake could do it? You sure?
We have a spot.
You sure? You get through the whole system? Start to finish? I love him, man. He's so positive. I love him. Start to finish? Madison Heights good because they got no approval process. Then they just rubber stamp stuff on there.
Oh, I do.
So
the mayor's smiling.
We got 20 topics.
So as Dan gets into the program, here's the question, particularly for our newcomers, that I want you to start thinking on anything. Whether it's someone wants to build a garage in your community, whether a restaurant needs a new sign, whether somebody wants to build a factory, doesn't matter. The question you ask is when do you need to open? If you're already open, when do you need the sign? If you start asking when do you need and setting a timetable for yourself and you work backwards, you can make it. Anybody can build that factory and be operational by March because there is a structural mechanism that says we need to have people in the plant on March 1st of 2018. And today is essentially July 1st of 2017. They haven't even started to write the plans yet. Can you do it? You can do it if you say you'll be in our plant, in that plant, in our community on March 1st, and we're going to work backwards and show you every step of the way of how you're going to do that. Now, Dan's going to talk about the five most important tools that you can have in your toolbox from a procedural standpoint and from a managerial standpoint that will allow you the structure on how to get there. Is it's not found in your master plan or your ordinance. It's found in these five tools. So with that, Dan, I'll give it over to you. I don't over my time.
You're good. Good. No, I think you're really good. You're on time.
Another ass kisser.
Extra minutes.
Another ass kisser, I'm just telling you.
That that economic forecast information, I've got some copies up on the table, and if we need more, we've got them. This is, yeah, as Matt said, it costs us $35,000. Many of you come and attend. But this is essential. And not just when times are good, when times are bad, we really need to know. That's part of that self-evaluation. Where are we? What are we losing? What do we need to get back? So those are available. Another comment on the jobs. In 2019, we'll be back to where we were, back 2002, 2003. Bob Datto is absolutely right. For those who know Bob Datto, he's our deputy county executive, and he says, you got 20 years plus trying to get back, maybe 30 years. And we're like, no way, this is Oakland County. He's wrong. Well, he understands the finances a lot better than many of us. So we've got this great job growth, but, and even with Brooks's emerging sectors, which is a big part of our economic development team of trying to diversify the economy, we know we're still automotive. Whether it's powertrain, whether it's connected, these are great jobs. So the emerging sectors are really, really helpful in medical and life science, in IT, but that's gonna be the challenge when things begin to turn. And they already have from an automotive sales. I don't think it's Panic City yet. Still gonna make 17 million vehicles this year. But yeah, 3% unemployment, that's great. There's still 20 to 25,000 people in Oakland County actively looking for jobs. It's a great time to land one. So our work's not done until, well, even if we get to 0%. But caution also with our automotive industry. Durable goods, first in, last out in a recession. Just a refresher, this is a five-year program. 2016, last year, we took a break so that we could go through the academy session again with all the communities. All the sessions are always open, but just to kind of refine what we've been working on aggressively the first 4 years. For the pilot communities, several pilot communities didn't want to participate. They thought they knew it all. I won't mention them. You probably would. But you know, 23 communities at this point are in the program. And you talk about the diversity. We were just having a conversation before we started. Madison Heights and Highland Township. Unbelievable difference. But you know, when it adds up to Oakland County in southeastern Michigan, it's really pretty awesome. Say that about all the communities. So 2017, welcome to Farmington Hills, Madison Heights, and Orchard Lake. Calfani is in trouble. He should be here tonight. Community focus, economic development. What is economic development? Pete Auger, former city manager of Marble Hills, and now Novi, he spoke a couple times. It's all about building relationships and maintaining relationships. That speaks to customer service and information sharing, not just one person at a desk. It's a team, it's elected, it's planning commission, it's anybody in the community that you might walk, somebody could walk up and ask you, what's going on, what's the process? Self-evaluation, we all have a lot of work to do there. We know we do at Oakland County. We were talking about it 2 hours this afternoon, weren't we? Just in our own department, there's some a lot of things that we can make better for communities and for businesses that are here now. They're our customers. Yeah, the taxpayers, they're our customers. So we always have to look at that self-evaluation. Purpose of the program, capitalize on communities, on the strengths of the community. with 61 communities in Oakland County, you add it all up, pretty impressive. Refine the economic development process, it's iterative, nonstop, ever-changing. When we started the program, we looked around, and there weren't a lot of communities doing this sort of thing. I think there was somebody in Florida, there was maybe Middletown of Ohio, and really marketed that, what they've done. What do we have? Yeah, we have a lot of incentives. We have time, we have our process. That's all on us as a collective community. So we find that economic process to implement that local vision. Matt's talking about think like an investor. Oakland County thinks like an investor. How do people perceive us? We're constantly asking that question. Sometimes we translate materials to make it easier for them to perceive us in what, 5 different languages for our business development folks. And the big question, what's your deadline? When do you want to open? Probably don't often ask that. Here's the site plan, here's the information. Do you have bank financing that's about to expire? You need to ask those questions. You got this on the community support?
Jane, you got a question?
Yeah.
Can you go back to work as partners? When you say capitalize on community strength, do you mean as individuals or do you mean as and this is how I know, where if I'm going to do something that's going to come to my city and I have to compete with my region, I'm hoping that instead of looking at, I want to put it here because that's what I want to make it, as long as it comes to this region, it's going to be good for all. So what do you mean by that?
That means each community should capitalize on their own strengths. So somebody comes to Highland Township and they want to put up an oil refinery. It's probably not going to happen anywhere in Oakland County, but it's not going to happen, but I know a place that it might. Let me pick up the phone and refer you to it.
Jane, a classic example is Tony, one of your trustees, said in a prior session a couple years ago, Pete Auger was teaching the management side of things. And Tony said, you know, we would love to get R&D facilities and we would love to get that, you know, the types of facilities that come to Auburn Hills. And remember, kind of a little back and forth went, and Tony said, well, listen, you got I-75 going right through Auburn Hills. That's got to help you. And Pete, without missing a beat, said, goes through Flint too, man. So the strength of Auburn Hills is the strength of Auburn Hills. Auburn Hills has a strength because there's a concentration in the cluster of international R&D facilities. There's a strength in the cluster of the way that they've built the tech park around FCA.
Okay.
For Waterford to say, you know what we should do in the next 2 years? Let's figure out a way that we can attract R&D
centers
from Japan.
It was
right?
Magnet.
Yeah. You know, it was the magnet.
Probably not.
So play to your strength. If you're really, really good at the way that your quality of life is enhanced, then focus your community strengths around how we can enhance that to have a greater sense of investment around what makes us really, really good. In Pontiac's case, if your community strength is kind of the dichotomy between the downtown and the rest, create a strategy that focuses on that instead of saying, you know, I think we should do, you know, we should chase down telecommunications companies because that would look really cool in that building. That's not focusing on the strength of who you are. That's what that means.
Or another example, in my mind, Pontiac capitalizing on its strengths, and the market is doing this, is the incredible infrastructure. Roads, water, sewer,
fiber.
So, you know, don't do something contrary to that. You know, build off of that infrastructure. And so that's for each community. Rose Township, rural, semi-rural, residential, do it well. If you have a commercial project, that's probably pretty important. Give it your all.
Yes. Okay, I like that. But what about diversification? Because I have a lot of put all my eggs on my basket, and you've done that before, and you saw what happened.
proactive. That's what we do as a county with emerging sectors. We didn't know anything about medical devices or IT and communication, so staff needs to learn that and then put themselves in a place where those folks are. First of all, take care of the ones in your own backyard. We have a ton. We have 2,000 IT and tech companies here in Oakland, software developers. Take care of them. And then you can go out and start pursuing them. Again, if it works off of the strengths of the community. That's a good question.
Rick, you know, playing that IT thing, you guys have Tech 248. And Highland, which is out in the middle of nowhere, somebody says, well, why would you decide to be proactive in Tech 248? Well, technology industry is pretty broad, but there's also an interesting number of individuals, younger individuals, that like to be inward or be out in more open space or whatever. Highland might be an awesome place for these smaller tech companies to locate because it gives them an environment to bike and to play as well as to do their business. So I've been going to these 248 meetings. A lot of times you go and go, wow, that doesn't really relate to me. But every time I've gone, I start to see this younger set of people who are asking questions. So why are you here? They ask, why are you here? Because I'm looking for you, that kind of thing. So it's a, how do you get out there and get somebody to come back and tell you something you don't know? You know, you have to go and learn that from somebody else.
That's the beauty. Part of that industry is beauty. It can be anywhere. The fibers there. You can live and work at home, close to home. There's also parts of the industry where they want to be near each other. They want to bounce off each other, you know, the coffee shop for breakfast and the coffee shop for lunch and the coffee shop for break. So there is the other side, and you're seeing a little bit of that.
One more strength that, you know, capitalize on a community strength that you need to think about. So who lives in your community? I mean, if you're a community where the top 10 restaurateurs of Southeast Michigan all live, then maybe you've got a pretty good strength about getting an idea of how to do a restaurant culture. If you're a community that has, you know, technical talent within it that you can rely upon to be guiding you in industry direction, that's a community strength that you have. If you've got people that are really, really solid at you know, developing a better way of doing, you know, parkland spaces, rely on those people. You know, bring them into the visioning process of who you are as a community. The people that live within your community can have the ideas. So you're right, it's not staying the same because I've got good roads and good fiber and those things, but it's also playing on the strengths of I mean, you guys just had the Mad Dog companies move. Play on that strength. I mean, a strength in your community is who you are as well as what you are. And so, you know, never forget about, you know, defining your vision. You know, no offense to any planners or engineers in the room, you know, but defining your vision is not your master plan. Defining your vision is who you are. And so your community's strength could be a group of impassioned people that have the ability to create your vision with you, and so you just don't leave them out of the box, so to speak.
Number three, you got to display that poster. In your lobby, got to. Lyon Township, I think, still has theirs, Rick. I think you do. You know, investor comes in the lobby and sees that. I'm sold. Well, maybe not sold, but very, very positive.
So when we started this,
it's kind of corny, but you know, you should play that. It doesn't mean that everybody's entirely in.
What is OSR, Ohio State? What?
So I'm going to talk a little less of Dan can get through this. They're all used to being interrupted, but here's why the poster is important. And in the new communities, I don't think we've had you sign that yet. Mm-hmm. You might say, well, what are you talking about? When we started this program, we said, well, like, look around you right now from your communities. There's three of you here from Oxford, right? There's not everybody here from Oxford. How many people are in the decision-making process in your communities to get something done? You know, usually there's seven on a board or council, and there's five or so on a ZBA, seven on the planning commission, you've got consultants, and you've got engineers that are writing reviews and building officials. You've got like 40, 50 people that are in the process to make one decision. And we have these things, and we say, you know, Southfield asked us last year, is it mandatory to come to be in? We're like, no. We're not gonna make you do anything, we're just gonna give you information. Your job is to take the stuff and make a difference. If it's the one thing that we do require mandatory, then everybody decides to post it. And here's why. Is when you buy into this and you realize how fun it is to work with people to engage in a manner of one-stop ready, and you still got those three, I won't swear, curmudgeons, better not swear word, that are back there, I want you to be able to walk over the posters, drag them by the ear and say, you signed the damn poster at one point. So at one point, you at least acknowledged that we're trying. That's the whole purpose of signing the poster. To tell the developers, yes, we're in. But you have, you guys are doing the learning. Drag them by the ear. We're not gonna be the same as we were 30 years ago. You signed the poster.
I remember Waterford, we were out to do the resolution, and then you invited us back, we're gonna do the poster. That was so cool. Yeah. So these are the best practices. And we're open to adding, but for 4 or 5 years, these have been the best practices that really seem to resonate. Probably the most important one is that pre-application meeting of the entire team, of those curmudgeons, wherever that curmudgeon is. And that pre-application meeting, depending on the size of the project, can be other entities. It could be Road Commission, it could be State of Michigan, MDQ. Early on, bring it. Internet accessibility. Decisions are made all the time without people showing up at your desk. We deal a lot with site selectors. They're paid by the Fortune 5000 and beyond to pick companies. And they're looking at your internet. And they're picking up information from that. Demographic data, ordinance information, attitude. And that's very, very important. Proactive tracking. Yeah, I know everybody's got BSNA, and it makes things much easier. But proactive project tracking is going the next step and making a call. Mr. and Mrs. Smith, you know, this is coming up next week. How you doing? Do you have any questions? Your site plan is due. That's being proactive. That's customer service. Clear and efficient permitting process. That's always a work in process, but extremely important. And then the last item there, the importance of business input. Businesses that you tap into on a regular basis. When you were up in Orion, you had a group on Friday mornings come out for a sandwich or something or eggs, and it was your way to tap in. They'll tell you good things that you're doing right and things you're not doing right. Chambers of Commerce certainly could play a role in that. Marie Hosworth in Waterford, great chamber. But always be seeking that input. Brooks has had an Oakland County Business Roundtable for 23 years. Originally, it's gonna be a 2-year stint. Give me your recommendations, I'm done, thank you. Participant said, hey, that was pretty cool because you're implementing a lot of those. So that's one of the mechanisms that we use to get that information, as well as going out proactively and calling and talking to a lot of business leaders and owners. One of these six is pretty close to each of your community. What shapes your vision as a community? Wish we could get real pictures, but these make the point. We have a lot of different types of lifestyles and visions, and that's terrific. You got to be who you are and work on things to improve. How do you work with your established vision? We got a map here, part of the master plan or zoning ordinance. That's great. You have to have a vision. I would suggest having like an economic vision. I know most people have capital improvement programs, but we've been talking about economic context. This is great for land use. Is the roadmap, it's the guidepost. But what's that economic vision look like? Where were we? Where do we want to go? What services do we provide? Again, I think a lot of communities cover some of that in capital improvement programming. on a regular basis for maintenance. But, you know, what would Madison Heights look like in 5 years? What would that economic vision be from a, just a pure and simple tax base standpoint? What would you like it to be? And how might you get there working off of this master plan? How do you respond when conditions change? We sure have seen a lot of change in the last, since that economic disaster of 2009-2010. We've seen whole perceptions and attitudes change from a planning perspective with non-motorized neighborhood, commercial establishments closer to or in neighborhoods. How do you react? When I first came to Oakland County, a wonderful community. Is anybody here from Troy? Troy, incredible master plan, great planning staff. Former city manager, Frank Kirsten. It was all about that master plan. And don't mess with it. Now, Troy could probably play that card. Probably worked pretty good. But I know several times, as economic development and business development, we were pretty frustrated bringing in a project that maybe was just a little bit off. That was a long time ago. Isn't the situation today? I was on Troy's website the other day, and the information that you have on projects is incredible for the citizens and those investors that are in the community and outside. So the master plan is a guide. Treat it as such. And then how do they view your community? This is something Site Guide has done every year, this is Area Development Magazine. This is a Site Selector publication. And the attributes listed here are the top attributes, as listed in a survey of the Site Selectors. This is what they look at. They're not looking initially at that master plan. Skilled labor. Highway, incentives, land and buildings, proximity to market, and that expedited permitting, kind of surprised me to see that, but glad to see it. It's in the top 10. You know what's not in the top 10? Quality of life. And it's not that it isn't important, but it's not what the focus is on. Getting a product out the door, or a technology out the door, cost of that, the sweeteners, the incentives, because every state is very, very active, or most states are very active in that. And the thing that we can control, the expedited permitting. So that's how investors perceive it.
So.
There's a theme here, right?
It doesn't say, of the top six things that someone looks to invest in this community, the most colorful master plan. It doesn't say the lowest site plan review fees. It doesn't say the most amount of planning commission meetings. All of that entitlement process couldn't be the furthest thing from the mind of somebody that's going to be looking at your community for anything. If they're looking to build a subdivision or a factory or a Tim Hortons, the things that go into, and these are more geared towards site selection when it comes to more major project work. That's why you need labor and some of the other things. But if someone's going to site a Tim Hortons or a Starbucks in your community, that would apply to all these communities. Linda was telling me that they permit Starbucks on the M1 district administrative area, which is great. Because of course, people that work in those environments like Starbucks. So why would you put them through an entitlement process of having to rezone land, get new master plan approvals to do all those things? It would be like, you know, you can't have Starbucks because the map has a purple square. As long as it has a purple square, we can't get Starbucks. Starbucks people aren't looking at that. They're looking at these types of facts. And they're also looking in that case, not only, they don't care about your zoning, they don't care about your master plan, they don't care about your fees. What they do care about, much like that Taco Bell restaurant on Baldwin Road, why they stuck with us and finally did it, was, what's the trip generation on that intersection? How many people are going by that? What's your rooftop income within the radius around that particular restaurant? So when somebody's looking at your community to cite something, even a small little coffee shop, we teach them in our business center, if it's just a mom and pop, it doesn't have to be a national, we teach them, listen, what's your cash flow, what's your demographics gonna be? We run all the softwares for them to teach them, and, you know, you can probably locate 2 miles away and be in the heart of a demographic area. So we do it on a local scale as well, but I can guarantee what we don't give one thought about in that center, what a national does, is how many planning commission meetings it's gonna take, except where we know it's gonna take a lot. And that gets into the process of the perspective of the investor. So if the investor is looking at this, and your community has a reputation of, yeah, these are nice, but our boxes are, it must fit our master plan, and you will go to a minimum of 5 planning commission meetings, and we are guaranteed to re-review your engineering drawings at least 4 times and charge you a fee every time. If that's the perception of your community, then you don't need to worry about it, because they will bypass you, and they'll never come to your community. And so the context of like, how does this apply to me? It applies to you and everything. And every little aspect. So if it's a small shop, if it's a garage, or if it's a big factory, these are the things that you as visionaries in your community need to be thinking. I know my master plan has a purple box, but how does my master plan account for, we've got a ton of skilled labor that lives in our community. And how do we play on that capital strength? So you start to see how the elements of this program try to wind your mind around to the point of, hey, this is what they look for. We have that. Because they're never going to look at the purple box.
No, I have to stay up there. I switched this next one.
Hey!
So, here's Auburn Hills, Great Lakes Crossing. And here's the Golden Mile. And here's that area that Matt was referencing a little while ago, Center Brown Road, the gateway to Orion Township. Where,
what's the saying for Orion?
Living is a vacation.
So this area is really challenged. And I have to admit, Carl and I were working back 20 years ago, looked at that and said, that's technology and research. Because what's right to the east over here, you got the palace, and you got this incredible technology and research park in Auburn Hills called Orion Township. And thinking was, well, we're going to run out of that land, that probably won't work. But with all this retail and shopping and the site conditions, very challenged topography, it really wasn't easy. But I think the township stuck with it for a good 15 years. And missed some opportunities. So the township has created a corridor improvement authority. You're going to make that 5-lane boulevard, running up on Baldwin and a little bit on Johnson. And there's a Menards going in there. So if that was still technology and research, probably Menards isn't going to be there. So that's basically working your master plan. Here's another one. Just down the road. The beautiful palace of Auburn Hills. But Auburn Hills said this is an opportunity. There's a state the mayor. This is disappointing. You walk in that facility, it is still incredibly beautiful. City is there's a picture. Partnership. Mr. Illich, Mr. Gores, and Mike Duggan. What's Auburn Hills' next play? What do they do? What's their response? Really aggressive internal planning analysis. Everybody. They had two teams. And I don't have the document here, but they produced a planning document. One of their teams was called Team Viper. Remember the hockey team? And the other was called Team Shock. The women's NBA. Kind of had fun with it. And they did work with Power Sports Entertainment. And so they came up with a couple of different scenarios.
So this is very active.
They're not gonna wait for the last concert, the last basketball game, which probably has already occurred, but if the Little Caesars Arena is not open in time, they could play another year out there. It'd be great, but they're not wasting any time. And so they did their perspective, and also general contractor, industrial, tech developer's perspective. And Powell Sports and Entertainment, very supportive. They're rezoning the site, as we speak, to move it from the general industrial to the technology and research. And they'll be ready. They'll be ready for the next stop. If if their Powell Sports Entertainment continues to use it, they're very supportive. But the market is such that we're seeing spec buildings built in that neck of Baldwin County. Existing space pretty much all been taken up. The model does work. An existing building is a heck of a lot cheaper than building a new one. Existing buildings are filled up even in Madison Heights. So we're seeing spec buildings, and they're going to be ready. There are users out there. If we could just get the silver to realize that as well.
Well, you know the problem there, right?
No, I know. It's property owner. Here's the property owner that's probably doing.
It's located at Pontiac. For my friends from Orchard Lake. So I know that, just in talking to the mayor there, you would love to find a way that you could more integrate, I call it advanced generation living. But if I'm correct, Mary, you talked about a little bit about how can we long-term vision for ourselves, the way that age in place within our city, still provide kind of a seamless way that we integrate that. If you wait for it to come, it'll come. It'll just be more difficult to come. It's much like I'm picking on Jane, I apologize, but she was about to say the reason we can't do the Silver Dome is the owner's but she won't say it. But this example with the Palace of Auburn Hills is no different than you and Orchard. To be thinking about, okay, our longer-term vision, so 5 and 10 years from now, we know that we're going to have this built up. What are the tools that we can do to get there? Instead of waiting for it to happen, instead of saying we have to rewrite our master plan, instead of, you know, no offense against the consultants, you don't need to write hundreds of thousands of dollars of checks for you to have an economic vision for yourself. And what are the tools? Auburn Hills brought in developers that said, here's what our vision would be. You can do the same. You can bring in people, hold your own charrettes, not to get yourself in any type of political turmoil, but just a vision. Where would it go? The most important person you can ask, what would we build and where would it go, is not us.
Not you.
It's the people that write the checks. If you get a check writer to give you advice, it's good advice. Because the check writer say, I'm going to write a check in your community. Hazel Park is not here. They've got, I think they still have an old CVS site that's on the corner. I don't think they've done that now or not. They got somebody in there.
Yeah, they do one, John Arnold. They have another one downtown. They have two old CVS.
So they said, bring us a user. And my response was, Talk to the developer about what they would do there. What's the barrier? We met with them yesterday, Brett and I, and in part spurred by Mabel Bragg, where there could be, I would call it a bar and restaurant district, but they call it a culinary district. No, they're aggressively, they want to know what the tools are, and our thoughts, and they're pursuing some new tenants for an old CVS that's not had anybody in it for eight or nine years. So be proactive. Don't sit back and say, oh, it's a purple box, I don't know what to do. Who cares it's purple, right? You know what to do for your community. So recap real quick before we move on to management structure with Gary and Rick. Gary, Rick talks more than I do, so we're in for a treat, right? So the five tools that Dan alluded to. Pre-application meetings. The importance of a pre-application meeting on anything. is that you give clear and concise information with those with write checks in your community, and then you stand by it. It's the factory incidents where I said, you can build the factory by March, because you've held a pre-application meeting that gives them all the details of it. And we were talking about the other day about types of things that go into a pre-application meeting. It's the type of things that only you know about. If you have a sense that this will never go there, because the 40-year trustee lives next to it, and you don't realize a check writer, that you're running into a buzz nest, the time to tell them that information is at the pre-application meeting, not at the fourth planning commission meeting, because they'll walk away from your community, never coming back and telling their friends there. So pre-application is very important. Linda?
And Matt, it's nice if we take that even further.
Good.
Or before that. We also have pre-application meetings as well. But before you even do that, when the developer's interested in a commercial or industrial site, you say they just have an interest or even have an LOI on it, or a letter of interest, okay? Before they actually sign and close on that property, we offer a pre-development inspection. Okay, so I have my building official and my fire marshal and myself, the three of us. These are the three decision, or two of the decision makers, okay? Who's gonna be ultimately giving you that ultimate certificate of occupancy to open up, right? So we do that we actually physically walk the building inside with the owner, the prospective owner, with the sign off of the property owner, and then treat it like a real inspection. We don't charge any of our, we don't charge our developers or prospective tenant. And we based on what they tell us, what they want to do, we say, okay, you might want to take a look at that fire suppression system. It's to eliminate those questions and the unknown stuff.
On site.
And they love it. It's been a huge success for us because our goal is the same as their goal. We want them in that building.
So there's one thing that, and Linda's catching it by her site walkthrough. There's one thing that I would caution you on in the pre-app is make sure people are participating. When I was in Orange Township, the fire marshal has to participate at some point in pretty much every site development. Our fire marshal, who I still love today, sat there with his arms folded in every pre-app. And I finally one day pulled him out and I said, Jeff, even I know that fire hydrant has to get moved to the other side of that drive. He says, it does. I said, could you walk back in there and tell him? He says, no, I'll do it when I review the site plan. I said, well, how about this? How about on Monday night, I ask the board to fire you? And then you can tell them after you get fired, because then it'll just be fun for them. He says, you don't have the power to do that. I said, well, I guess we're just going to find out. It got to that point with Jeff. We're still really good friends. But he refused to participate. The pre-app meeting must have participation. So if you're struggling within your community to get participation, do what Gary and Rick and I, this is who we are, right? This is who we are, you're expected to do it. Internet accessibility. We have 1,062 foreign owned multinational companies in this town. That means we have tens of thousands of foreign nationals that live in Oakland County, they live in all your communities, they work in all your communities. If a company wants to get information about should they come to Oakland County and they have to fly here because you don't have all your information on your website, then they won't come here. That applies to Starbucks and Ace Hardware and everybody else too. Internet accessibility is very, very, very important. Project tracking, Dan said it, proactive project tracking. So many people say, we track our projects, we put it in BSNA, and there it sits. If you want to make it so that the developer is not mad at you, and it's their fault, everybody would love to blame the developer because the developer blames all of us, right? If you want to blame the developer, then you call the developer and you say, just a reminder, your site plan is due on Thursday if you're going to make that meeting. And remember, you want to be open March 1st. If you don't make this meeting, here's the alternative plan. I'll call you on the day up. You have proactive tracking because they can't say, oh, they blew my whole date for me. Proactive tracking. Expedited and concise permitting process. If your inspectors are writing tickets willy-nilly, we need to have a discussion with your inspectors. If your inspectors on the other side are not inspecting your properties as people are building things because they're going on their timetable, they need to be reminded that they signed the sanction. Clear and concise. You cannot have an efficient development process where people really, really brag about you unless the expectation is very clear. If it's going to take 4 weeks to get something done in your permit process, tell them that. Don't take their stuff, promise them a permit, and then when they call in 3 days, it's not there. We have academy sessions on all of these, the business community stuff, you know. We have academy sessions on all these things that will be in the future. For those that are first time in the program, we would encourage you to encourage your friends that didn't come tonight to come to those sessions. Probably the most fun and significant one is the perspective of the investor. We bring in a big developer, we bring in a mid guy, and we bring in an entrepreneur that's opened something. So we brought in the guy that started Valentine Vodka. Valentine Vodka or somebody else? Yeah, Valentine Vodka. You would be shocked at how these entrepreneurs have no clue how to build a business in your community. The most important thing that comes out of that is everybody thinks particularly the big developer is gonna voice, I hate your planners and the process, no, no. The number one thing is you hear them explain the importance of consistency and honest timing in what you do so that they can make an informed decision on what they're doing. So all of these things are talked about, but if you can focus on those five things in your community, being proactive, Madison Heights is over the top, making sure everything is accessible, making sure that you track your projects so that you never fall behind anything, nothing gets lost in the process, and make sure that you're clear and concise and upfront and honest about your permitting and you try to expedite. In Grand Rapids 5 years ago, when we started this program, we're surveying around what's going on. Grand Rapids back then, they probably are still doing it now. We're processing over 10,000 building permits a year. Each one of them in less than 48 hours. That's your competitor. Do you have a process that allows you to expedite the review and the receipt of permitting going forward? So those five particular things. So you got a good news, bad news. Good news is I have to run somewhere because we're working on a very, very significant political bill, and I've got to go say, oh, you're running for Senate, hooray, please vote for our legislation. So I've got to go do politics, so I apologize. That's the good news, I'm leaving. It's good, I won't talk too much. The even better news is Dan's going to facilitate a great discussion with Gary Wall and Rick Hamill. They've been two huge advocates of this program, and so I'm sure you two a good job sharing that. All right, so next step in the process. And Kalfati King, he's buying a drink.
Gentlemen, come on up.
Yeah, we need a break.
Do you want to sit here for a question, Jess?
Tell us a little bit about what you've been working on.
HB4W.
Oh, geez, I'm doing the alphabet. I'm going to start out with how I got involved in this process. There was a planners gathering down in Ferndale back in 2014 and that I attended. And Brett was talking about this program, One Stop Ready, and I said, well, what's this all about? And he said, well, stop by and check it out. Well, I kind of broke into the meeting and invited myself to be a part of it. And it turned out to be what you're looking at today. And the reason that it was important to me was that I was hearing these things about the style of management that I thought was important for our community, and why would I reinvent the wheel when I've got somebody from Oakland County that can help me do the same process? So the interesting part about the meeting, and Matt left, so he can't refute this, but the first thing he did is he went around the room and he introduced everybody, and he said, Rick, he says, do you know what the building people think about Highland Township? Of course, I sat there and I kind of, and now this may sound really rude, but in reality, it was the kind of thing that, you know, breaks your head open. He said, they think you're assholes. And he says, now don't take that personal. And I said, I don't take it personal. And he said, think of it in the terms that when you have builders and developers and anybody that wants to look at your community, and they've heard from somebody else that it's so difficult to work there, that they kind of, you know. So I thought, wow, you know, that's something that I think really needs to be addressed. Well, I got involved politically by the exact same issue. I used to be a builder. I was a landscaper, landscape designer. I spent a lot of time going in for permits and things in our facility. My wife's a CPA, and I retired in 2006, and I said, I'm gonna build my wife an office in the downtown. We have a DDA. I want to be a key person to start a process that people can use as a guide. So the first thing I do is I buy a piece of property and I tear a building down and build a new building for my wife, and she moves in, and 2 weeks later I get a letter that says you need to move out. You didn't, you're not zoned for it. Wow, this is interesting, because I spent every week in that office going through this whole process, building permits, the whole thing, and then I'm told we're not zoned for it. So I learned the process at that point. One is immediately ask for a zoning appeals, because then that puts everything on hold and she could stay in her office, and I ran that thing to 364 days and then requested a meeting. Well, it turns out that I had to get it rezoned. She didn't have to move out, but it was that process of the negativity that went along with that. And so I thought, okay, I'm going to get involved in the Downtown Development Authority. Well, it turns out that our leadership was actually engaged in a program to do away with the DDA. And I found out about that in a really strange way by reading the law. And the net effect was is that, yes, they were trying to do away with the DDA, and I made it my commitment to not let that happen. So I was able to roadblock that. Of course, I wasn't very popular with the planning or with the township board after that. But I was sitting in a meeting, and I had requested to be on a DDA board, and I was the only one that had requested it. And our supervisor at the time said, came up on the agenda, and she says, currently no qualified people for the position. And we had our DDA board there, and everybody's like, wow. I mean, I've got background in design, building, construction, everything you can imagine. And I'm thinking, okay, I guess it's qualifications are a lot higher than you could expect. So at the end of the meeting, a public comment, I stood up and I said, I raised my hand. She said, what do you want now? That's the kind of intensity that you really don't want to see. And I said, well, I'd like to know why I'm not qualified. The answer was, as long as I'm supervisor, you'll never be on the DDA board. And my head said, I need to be supervisor, because I'll automatically be on the DDA board. I never served on the DDA board until I became supervisor. And I ran never intending to not win. I mean, I never thought about not winning. And I had, I don't know, Tammy, do you remember how many people ran against? There was probably seven people ran against me. And I never thought that I wouldn't be supervisor. So that here I am in a position where suddenly I've got to change that attitude.
That leads into the first question very, very well.
Right.
Gary, your experience is almost the same, being a business person in construction and kind of looking at things a little bit different in Waterford.
Yep. I said, well, I had 40 and a half years in the construction business, primary residential, because I was not a union person. If you stayed away from commercial, you stayed away with trouble from the union, so that was by design. But going in, they said, I'd had experience with building departments countywide, and Waterford was always a good community to deal with, a good building department permitting process, but there's always room for improvement. So knowing that and coming in, but again, once you're on the inside looking out, it's a whole different world. You get to know the people, you get to understand the process. And once you get involved in this, please don't ever get comfortable. People in government have a tendency to get comfortable, and when you get comfortable, it starts to backslide. And when it's a backslide, you have to make that ground back up again where you can move forward. I'm not talking about micromanaging. I'm not trying to be hovering over your people like a helicopter dad, but I'm just saying, make sure that you follow up on it and you're involved in it and you completely remind the people. As soon as this is over again, for the fourth year in a row, we're gonna have another one-stop ready meeting at our township with all the department heads and the building department, because it's critical for this to happen. Waterford's a primarily developed community, and as Dan can attest, and Matt's been involved in it, the Summit Place Mall down there is our proverbial stone in our shoe, but we've got an offer in place. We're trying to close it out and get it going, but that would be huge for us. But we're also working with White Lake on an upcoming project, and we have several things in the hopper right now. but you have to stay on the people. You can't just assume that they're doing their job. You gotta follow up. You gotta do emails, you gotta make phone calls, you gotta visit people, go out to the sites, look at it, familiarize yourself with it so that you know. Because it's critical that you're, I don't care what position you hold in the community, if you have a position in the community, be involved. Make this stuff happen. You don't have to do it to grandstand, get elected to a political officer, get promoted to another position. You're doing it because you care. You have a vested interest in the community. I mean, I've been in Waterford Township for 62 plus years. I'm never going to leave. I'm going to die there. I know there's some people would like to see me go sooner than later, but put that aside, the bottom line is, you have a vested interest in your community, and you know, step up and do what you can do to make this stuff happen. And then once it's in place and it's been implemented, follow up and make sure it stays in place. Come back to these seminars and make sure you get caught up with the next year and the next year and the next year. There's something happens new every year. Don't depend on modern technology. Well, it's in the system, it'll get done. No, that doesn't work. Just make sure you make it happen. And I tell you, the results are great. And like I said, this program, it uncovered a lot of stuff, like I said, that I'd never experienced. I spent 40 years pulling permits and dealing with municipalities. And I can tell you, when you're dealing with a municipality, it's difficult, and the private sector takes money out of your pocket. Because if you're not working because you're held up on the permitting process, it takes money out of your pocket. It isn't a guaranteed every 2 weeks, whether you work or not, you get a paycheck. It doesn't work that way in the private sector. You gotta get out and you gotta hustle, but you have to have cooperation from our end too. So you gotta make it happen. And again, everybody here is from a municipality. What's your number one source of revenue? Tax dollars from property tax, right there. Unless you guys have something illegal going on, and if you do, then you can't talk about it. So, but it's just, it's tax revenue from development. It is. That's your number one source of revenue right there. So
we've got some questions here. Anybody see a question there that they'd like to ask either Gary or Rick about a particular aspect of the One Stop Ready? Number five, do you ask the applicant when they need to be in the building or break ground?
I said, Matt says, when do you want to move in? If you ask him that and the general contractor gets behind schedule, guess who's going to call? The Township Building Department. We ask them when they want to start. Then you take that date and you work back there and you try to make it happen. They tell you 3 weeks, make it happen. Special CBA meetings, special Construction Board of Appeals meetings, special Planning Commission meetings, whatever it takes, you make it happen. And remember, if you've got boards, and I'm not talking about being a dictator or being retaliatory, but I'm saying, if you've got people on your commissions that aren't getting the job done, when their time's up, replace them. It's easier to pull teeth than it is to get somebody off a board. But when their time's up, if they're not doing the job, why would you want them on there? You want people learning that they're proactive, that want to get the job done. They have an open mind. They look at it like Matt said earlier. You're not bending the rules. You're not cheating. You're expediting the process. I had a guy talk to me a while back when I first came in. He says, I reviewed 22 plans today. You reviewed 22 plans for jobs. He goes, yeah. It was a Friday. So what'd you do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday? They'll let them pile up on your desk. He says, why don't you reveal 22 plans over 5 days rather than doing them all in one day? And I know there's a method to all madness, but just stuff comes in, process it, deal with it. Because tomorrow, there'll be something else to process and deal with.
And another one here, I'd be interested in your response. How do you empower staff to offer guidance to an applicant that will carry forward to the review and approval process? And that's management, that's leadership.
That's one of the things that was difficult in our situation, because we've had employees who have been there for one administration after another administration, one individual's 38 years now. They become embedded with a thought process of how to do things. What you have to do is, number one, by going through the process and having them go to these meetings and get that one stop, and repeat it over and over again, then to watch their performance and say, okay, in a number of the cases that I've had, I'll get a phone call from a contractor. Rick, I was in and, I was told 2 weeks and something's going to, it's not happening like I think it should happen. And then, when we first started out having this issue and the one-stop-ready thing, so then it was okay. by law, I really can't do those jobs. You know, I'm the supervisor, but I can't permit, I can't do any of that. I'm not an officer of the court for zoning, blah, blah, blah. So you have to make those individuals understand that they are the ones that make it happen. And that they do have to present themselves in a way that says, we're gonna get this for you tomorrow. And if they say tomorrow, they need to perform. Does it happen all the time? No, but then you've gotta go in and reiterate and reiterate. Now, we could eliminate their job and hire somebody new, but I'm the kind of individual that when you've got a lot of historical knowledge in an individual, don't waste it, but help redirect it. And so we're coming along very well on it. And I think that the nice thing about it is that what I hear in response and return, you know, from the business community is it's not the same world it was before. And that they feel comfortable when they come in that they're gonna get the answers that they want. And a lot of times I'll be at, you know, I'm one of those that wanders around, I can't sit in front of a desk very long. And I hear everything. So my head puts it together like puzzle. I'll be walking through the building department and I'll hear somebody say three or four words and I go, oh, that's that project. Now I'm gonna listen to what's being said. And if I see the direction kind of not heading that way, I'm in there. And then we reiterate the one-stop ready thing. Our building official is fantastic at it. I mean, he listened to that the first time he came here, and that's the first thing he asked, when do you want to be in? And then it's how do we work together to do that? Our fire chief is right there, so we have our, you know, the pre-application meetings. When you were talking about going out in advance, I've had a number of people say, Rick, why are you out with real estate agents? And I said, I'm not with the agent, I'm with the individual that wants to buy it. And I want to be there and hear what the agent's telling them, so that same thing. Do you really know what you can do with this building? I'm here to tell you what you can do, and if you've got something creative, then I'm also there to hear that and say, maybe we can get something out of the box here and help you pull that through. And as a response to that, we've got real estate agents now that go, Rick, we'd like you to meet with us and the client in advance, because we want to know what we can do with that. Instead of telling them, yeah, you look at that big building, that's industrial. No, it's not. It's retail. So, you know, you want to be able to try and chase away the bad attitude by giving them the right information immediately. And in that, almost all those cases, when you say, well, here's some of the roadblocks you're going to hit, at least they can look at it and say, I can do that. I got the resources to cover that, to cover that. Then you can move forward. And so it's important from, you know, my perspective as what the public thinks is the leader, and that I can do everything. It's important for me to go out and to personally meet with these business owners. And I think that what has happened from that, I did develop a business roundtable very, very early in, actually the first year I was in office, and I got to meet 300 and some odd business owners. And they all know that if they have a question, they can come to me, talk to me, walk in my door any point in time. And the other part is if they have something that I know somebody else could partner with, then I have that knowledge and I can help them. And it makes a big difference in how the business world looks at our office and the process.
First question up there. We're not going to go through all of them, and we'll be here all night. How has the One Stop Ready program impacted the way that the supervisor, township board, planning commission, and staff interact with each other? If so, how? Gary?
Well, I just view it as an eye-opener. Again, like I said, when I came into office in 2012, I was perceived as a, let's say, a bad person. I don't know. But it just, there was a lot of people that left the township before I come in because they'd heard stories. And the reason I know this is because I've been in office for 4 or 5 months. People didn't know me a little bit. It just said, I'm very business-oriented. You got to get stuff done. You got to get stuff done expeditiously. And a lot of times, like Rick said earlier, once people have been in government, sometimes 36 years, I refer to as getting comfortable. The incorrect word would be lazy. They get self-entitlement, whatever it might be, but they need to be nudged a little bit. And when you push people, and I had a couple other people leave within 2 years, they decided to retire because they didn't want to be pushed. And I wasn't being nasty to them. I wasn't mean to them. But we got to get stuff done. I know you're understaffed. I know we cut back. I understand that. But the economy's turning back up again. You're processing more permits. There's more plan reviews. There's more ZBAs. There's more planning commissions. There's more constructive board of appeals. Because there's more business, and the more business we get, the more tax revenue it's going to generate. The more tax revenue it generates, more money we're going to have to work with. It's all win-win-win. If we get enough, we can hire some more people back up to help you out. In the meantime, you've got to make it work, whatever it takes. And you're not asking anybody to risk life and limb, or, you know, do anything, or come in and work for free, but you got to make it happen. And you have to get that point across. So again, this program made this very possible. We had a good turnout. We had about a dozen people here from the township, and then we brought it back and had all the department heads and all the, you know, the ZBA and the planning commission, the construction board of appeals, everybody in the auditorium, and then basically you come to Jesus meeting. This is the way it's going to be. This is what it's got to be, and get the point across and get it. And I don't know anybody that took it negatively. I didn't see anybody walk out of their shoulders down thinking, my God, I can't do it anymore. It didn't work that way. It was positive, and it's picked up. But again, I had a call here back in March, and the guy says, I dropped a permit application off 4 weeks ago. And I said, you should have it by now. So I went upstairs, and one of the girls, Doug, too, says, here it is. I said, pick up two things. Call him, tell him how late we're open and how much your permit is. Before the day was out, he picked it up. But it shouldn't have had to go to that. But once it did, you make it happen. You got to make it happen, because these people, they want to do visit, and you don't want to get a bad name about your community, because it will drive people away. I know that for a fact. I saw it happen in business.
I think that one of the important things is that if I'm the individual that first came to this and I thought this is a great idea for our community, it's my responsibility when I see somebody start to fall off the wagon and not make a phone call, hey, make the phone call. That is exactly the same thing as you just don't let it fall. I could have gone, well, they didn't call, so that guy's not going to come back. You have to step out there and take that lead and show that, okay, call, and in a nice manner. Oh, geez, I guess I could have. Yeah, you could and should do it. And it works, because then they get a response back and they find out, hey, that didn't hurt so bad. I, you know, and you retain somebody. So, I go ahead. Yes.
When you're done, I'd like to ask a question.
Sure.
It has to do with a linear effect. I did retail construction for many years. And everything that you're talking about, what I would see, I would create my budget, my deadlines, everything from my opening. So if I had 16 weeks, I knew everything I had to do within that 16 weeks to be open, and I always sent my site supervisors into wherever we were to talk to who the inspectors were, explain what our accomplishments needed to be, and help us get there. So they understood the projects. And I have to say that even I'm in West Bloomfield now, and we did a storm West Bloomfield, and we had an opportunity to say, okay, we're behind on this, or we can't accomplish this. How can you work with us, and how can we work with you to keep moving to make our deadline? At the time, that was the exception to the rules, I think. Because I think what's happened is cities and townships have said, okay, this is our process. This is what you have to do to meet our process. And this is the reverse, saying we want to have you here. So the ability to have strong people within and have that autonomy to say, you know what, we can make these decisions, we're not going to compromise on what we're going to, safety, those types of things. This is kind of the permission overall that says, and then the support that comes down and says, this is really a program. Do you find that having the program here that gives that support to your credibility as supervisors?
Absolutely.
And the documentation that also eliminates some of the fear and the resistance to change
and brings out some of that confidence that some of your individuals have had out in the field to say, this is what we can do for you to help you keep your project moving along, to have a, make the exceptions and not the rules.
Well, when,
you're on a roll.
When, I think the thing is that when you look at communities overall in the past, when things were real sweet and lots of money rolling in, it was easy to turn people away. It was easy. I mean, you could just, we'll just get at it when we want to get at it. And you could tell people, we want you to add this and add that to this plan and that plan, without regard for the fact that it's costing additional money, but money was good, so they wanted to do it. Now, when you don't have, you know, when we had that downturn and you don't have people knocking on your door and trying to do these things, you have to look at it completely differently. I was in a retail business as well. Every individual was my paycheck. And if you don't think the same way as a supervisor, as a planning commissioner, as our clerk, that's our paycheck. We cannot afford to treat those people any different than, you know, they always say customer's king. There's a difference between king and treating them as the individual and with total respect. So what it does do is that, to give you an example of timing, you know, you come in and you've got this amount of time. We've had our planning commission go, okay, they got on board with it. Boom, they had either a special meeting or they doubled up on the process. We would fit people in. It used to be that if you weren't in by a certain date, you'd have to go on the next planning commission meeting. And I'd go, they're standing here right now. And we haven't sent anything out yet, so let's put them on it. Well, they don't have the paper. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Can you get the paperwork? Yeah, I'll have it here later today. That's what you have to look at. How can we help you accomplish what you're going to do? And when you get the mindset in the office to do the same thing, then it works. I'm going to give you an example that happened today. That's really an interesting element of people thinking one-stop ready, but it's all internal. July 7th, we have two individuals. One's getting married. The other one has to deal with some medical issues in our building department. They're two key employees. You know, somebody comes in, they aren't there to answer the question. So we go to the clerk's office and say, can we borrow Julie for the day to set her there? Well, then I find out that my office, both of my girls are going to be gone. Well, I'm the assessor, and so the Karen, who's the assessor, is now all freaked out because she's got a medical thing that she has to go take care of, and she's worried that she's not going to service the public. And our whole team is looking at it. We have to make sure, they're all going, well, here's how we're going to do it. We're going to make sure that we don't miss a single person. That was something that never happened in the previous 4 years that we had when I was in the office. And it's because I firmly believe everybody on our team now gets it. And our ZBA has changed some of their process, you know, so that it used to be that you had to wait until the next ZBA meeting to get the minutes made official to be able to go ahead and get your permit and roll forward. Well, now there's instances where you can look at it and say, we'll authorize it at the end of the meeting. So those are things that you have to look at. How can you start the expedition? I really want to find out whether a township can do the same as a city like Madison Heights, whether you can have an administrative rule or whatever. So
another question, Rick.
These things are really nice because we're all in the position of being public officials of some area or not. How do you deal with the public who then comes to your meeting and either the Mr. Naysayer, as we've said before, or they come in mass and complain about something that's going in at that point? You know, we've had many of those meetings where, you know, you have public hearings and you have 50 people. When our Myers went in, we had to have it in Akiva and the high school, and they actually had to go for a referendum and we voted it in, and now everybody loves it. But the point is we had to deal with that. Well, that was before one-stop chocolate, one-stop ready. But how then do you explain, I mean, this is good here, to the public that these are good things
the audience to go, ooh.
Well, one thing we did was, or was early on, was to introduce it into the newspaper. And to have a process that talks about here, you know, come on in, listen to what we have to offer. Now, in terms of when you do a project, a major project, I think the key on that one is that you have to educate to the nth degree of what's happening, and you're always gonna have the 50 that are gonna show up. But what's the rest of your population? If you've got 40,000 people and 50 show up, I think, you know, 39,000 of them are okay with it.
And I yell at those people too when they come to the meetings and say, where were you before, but yeah.
One community, anybody here from Auburn Hills? Not somebody that's here. Something that they indicated that they do on, if not every project, almost every, is that they give a list with labels and names of nearby businesses or residents to the developer. Here you go, we suggest strongly that you go talk to them, you know, over a cup of coffee, and so that when they come to the Planning Commission, they worked it out, they've done their homework, they've met with the neighbors, whatever the issues are, they've done that.
Yeah, I'm just so glad that question was raised, that's key. I mean, you encourage, it's one thing for the city to put in the paper, do this and do that and tell public, but the savvy developer who knows what they're doing, and this comes back to the planning, to the pre-application meetings, is the developer who goes and knocks on that door of those neighbors and introduces themselves and introduces their project, because there's nothing more that they can do than a resident can feel, because you could have the exact same project and meet the same end with, whereas before you had the public against it, but at least they feel engaged and said, hey, this developer came and they knocked on my door. And I know there's sites that in the past could not get developed because they didn't do that, but that's where those employees who've been there 35 years.
They know.
Oh, the Hank lives in that neighborhood. You better
here's all your neighbors. Here's your address. Here's your contact information. I strongly urge you to go do that. Here's the label.
They're going to talk to all of them. They just can't come back.
Oh, no. Well, I think developers, you know, well, will they talk to all? I think they attempt to.
They need to talk to the majority. And I say this strongly, Dan, because, you know, they'll, we recommend them, as you all do, you know, go talk to the folks. And we can't tell them how to do it or whatever. But they'll only talk to the people that are, you know, nice or whatever, you know. They won't talk to the tough ones, the ones that don't want the project to occur. And so then they come to the meeting and they tell us, oh, we talked to everybody.
The key is the community suggesting and making it easy for that developer, if you know there's going to be a question, to make those contacts. Can't do it for them.
We had a contentious project in White Lake a few months ago, and we put the question to the developer and said, would you meet with the residents? And then when they said yes, I said, well, call me tomorrow. We'll schedule the boardroom, and I'll sit in there with you. So what was he gonna say? At that point, he had said he would meet with them. I offered him space, and I was gonna sit there so I didn't throw fruit at him. And so I kind of forced his hand. He had to meet with them, and everyone at that meeting knew, it was on public record, that he was gonna be at a place in time. And it actually went pretty well having it at a neutral site at Township Hall. But people who were friendly, people who weren't terribly friendly, all showed up, and we had a pretty good dialogue, and then we were able to, you know, advance through the process and report back to the Planning Commission. This meeting did, in fact, happen, and there were some pros and cons that came out of it. These things have been overcome as hurdles and obstacles. These we're still working on. So that when the staff gets involved to kind of bridge that gap, I think that can be helpful.
And on something like that, it doesn't hurt for local people to get involved, not to advocate for or against, but it's the developer, but the local people too. And I can tell you from experience, when you're dealing with people in board meetings, like Rick made an example, we have a pit bull being in Waterford Township, if you're not aware of that, and we get people by the hundreds come out to the meetings. So as I say, hundreds, 150, 175 people come out, but in a municipality that has 73,500 people, you know, there's a lot to be said for the silent majority and the vocal minority. There's a lot to be said for that. The one thing I have found out, everything that's a major issue, you know what I'm saying, that's the end of the world, 6 months after it's over with, you never hear about it again. You don't. And the people that were complaining, you see them at that Meijer store, or you see them at the Ace Hardware, or you see them at the Burger King, or Taco Bell, or the flower shop, whatever it is. But again, people like to be heard, and you got to listen to them, you got to be respectful. But at the same time, again, you got to look at the whole picture, and you can't allow a small group of people to come in and influence. You got to listen to them, but you got to make decisions that are going to have an overall effect on an entire community, not just, you know, people. And they may be dead right. You may be blind to something. They may open your eyes to something that you didn't know anything about. But again, like I said, it's just, I've seen it go both ways with our, not our current board, but our previous board. I've seen it go where they were strongly influenced by just a few people, or where they were, unfortunately, one of them was in 2016, and I think too many people were thinking about votes rather than, but two of the people decided with that and didn't get reelected. So, I mean, did it work or didn't it work? You know what I'm saying? You just don't know. But forget about that. Put all that aside. You've got a job to do, and it's not to work and get reelected. It's to serve your community what's in the best interest for the entire community, not to say people don't have a right to voice their opinion, and not to, you're not to listen to them. But when all is said and done, you got to look at the whole picture and make the right decision that will benefit the vast majority.
One more question, and then how are we doing on time, Ryan?
8:17.
Okay. Vision, trying to have a shared vision. When you've got Township Board, Planning Commission, and ZBA, DDA, or Court of Improvement, how do you make that happen?
Well, you try to get people on board, try to get to meet. You have crossover members. Some in the ZBA has been a Planning Commission. Somebody from the Planning Commission has to be the Construction Board of Appeals, so that helps. But you have to explain, you have board members that are on these too, and you have to explain them. You're the representative of the Township Board. You're supposed to take our information and share it with them, and whatever information you get from them, you bring back and you share with your board. Open line of communication. You have to keep an open line of communication. You have to communicate. Don't rely on Twitter and Facebook and emails and all this stuff. And I know people are going to think I'm a freak. I still have a flip phone. I resign strictly to meeting with people and talking to people. And one thing I found out, you call somebody back and 90% of the problem evaporates. It does. You got to communicate with people. They're elated to hear from you to make it happen. But you just got to start internally and then spread out. And it works. I can tell you it works like a charm.
Periodic, once a year, every 18 months, of all those boards and commissions, just to try to get on that same page.
Yep, like I said, we'll have an annual meeting for the One Stop Ready, and we'll get together and share any ideas, any new ideas, and I know these new groups are going to come up with new ideas that we didn't think of before. And we'll have that meeting with department heads, like I said. I don't care if it's the treasurer's office, assessing, the building department, I don't, clerk's office, supervisor, it doesn't matter. Everybody's involved in this. I mean, the DPW for sewer taps, water taps, we're talking to the Oakland County Road Commission. I mean, just like I said, I've seen, and again, previous life I dealt with Oakland County, and they weren't the easiest persons to deal with at times. Not anymore. You call the road commission 3 days, you got a driveway permit for residential. You just do, or you used to take 2 or 3 weeks to get it. You know, you just, like I said, concrete guys coming on Thursday, you need the permit now so you can put the culvert and get the driveway for it. I mean, just these things have to happen. And I mean, it does. It just goes like that now, and it makes a big difference. But it's communication internally and externally both. You got to talk to the other entities that you're dealing with. You do.
We had a joint boards and commissions meeting, and you guys came out to Highland and gave a whole, an abbreviated version of the program, and I think that made a huge difference, and it was really appreciated, because what happens is it's hard to get, you know, one or two people to keep coming and, you know, educated, but when you throw it out in front of everybody at once, it's a big impact, because that is stating that you are trying to drive for a vision, and that vision is kind of twofold. Every one of these, the communities are all completely different about, you know, Madison Heights has got residential and industrial and Waterford's got more residential and retail, and Highland is rural. But it's not really rural, but it's rural. You know, we've got 20,000 people, can't see most of them because they're on lakes and, you know, hidden in subdivisions. So when you try and do a vision, you know, what is the vision for Highland? Well, everybody says rural. Okay, so how do you impart that on, you know, you got a planning commission that is looking at a master plan that says we need to keep this rural. So it's difficult to get everybody on board, but once I think everybody starts to see the crafting and getting a better real picture, and I think that the key is, I made a joke one time at a planning commission meeting before I was in office that I thought the master plan looked like something that the kids had colored at Big Boy. And that's about what it would tell you, you know, and that didn't go over very well, but it was, it's the statement is that you can't look at those and really tell what's happening in a community. It's there to help craft it when somebody comes in to ask, where can I locate something, but in reality, you have to start to put out literal visions. And having been a landscape designer, that was my forte. So how do you get a vision that somebody's going to pay money for, you know? And I was very successful at it for years, so.
We're having any time to come out. I know we did it before you were in Rick's and Steve. Probably 3 years, 3 years ago. Came back out and it was a joint meeting, just to kind of run through executive summary, and hopefully that got the discussion going. It was a good discussion when we were there.
On the master plan?
Yep. Well, just the vision, kind of. The vision, and I mean, you're a business friendly community, that's Wicks and Roots, but you know, it'll be better. So, we're happy to do that. Any other questions for these two gentlemen? Yes, sir.
You also, somebody comes in with a proposal, you know, it just isn't going to work in the community, it's just too far up. You got to tell the developer right up front, okay, what the deal is. Because developers don't make money trying to go to war. They make money by building and they'll move on to a different site. So respect the community for being straightforward to them and being honest with them.
There's the interesting thing to that is that Highland being a rural community, and somebody comes in and I can say, I could say up front, that's not going to work. But in reality, what you need to do is look at what they're saying to you and say, can you make it work? And what is it that you can do to maybe mold an idea that maybe both parties would benefit from? And when you get to that point where it just says the magic no, that means you've looked at everything possible to try and make it work. And then you can say, well, you know, it's not going to be. But within that process, that developer, and I've seen it happen because I've talked to people in that process, when they hear how you're trying to help them make it work, then they start to put the pieces together, wow, this probably isn't the right property. And they'll stop at that point, and yes, they are happy that you've taken that time because they didn't go through all the other crap to deal with it. So it's find all the yeses first, and then the no is going to come pretty much in, you know, by a consensus.
But sometimes you might know that. I mean, it's just...
Yeah, we might know right from the get-go, yeah, it's not going to work.
Let's give these two gentlemen a good round of applause.
I got one more thing I'd like to say.
Yeah.
Any new communities...
Are people staying in Waterford?
They're not supposed to be. No.
Any of the people that are new communities, to me this is a very important first element of One Stop Ready. How many people know where Highland House is or have been to Highland House? Okay. Highland House is building a new
restaurant.
They're building a new restaurant.
Really good red sticks.
So they happen to be very close friends of mine, and you know, I'm like, they've been in our community for 60 years. The last thing I want to see is have them pack up and go. They've had trouble with the health department. They've had trouble, we don't have water, we don't have sewer, and they're having to jump hoop after hoop after hoop while they're looking at another 100,000, another 100,000, another 100,000. So, I don't know how many of you know of the Clement Company. They're like a general contractor. Probably one of the most organized individuals I've ever seen in my life. And he comes in with a really beautiful sign that says, coming soon, you know, Highland House with a picture of it, and Clement Companies. Wow, that's really cool. We denied it. And I'm like, whoa, what was that all about? So it's our zoning administrator who's looking at the, doing the sign. It should have been really, we're moving that to our building department now, so we have somebody else looking at it from a different perspective. So I get this phone call. They designed a temporary sign that's beautiful, you know? And so the guy comes in my office and he goes, I don't believe it. So I'm looking at it and I go, wow, this doesn't make sense. I said, let me see what I can do. So I talked to our zoning administrator and I said, what's wrong with this sign? The materials are too permanent looking. And I'm starting to go, oh my God. So all of a sudden I get this phone call from one of the owners. Rick, we can move to Heartland where they have sewers. And if we're going to start out with a sign, and we can't put a contractor's sign up to tell people we're going to build a new restaurant, what's coming next? And that's my point. Don't let that little detail turn them away. And I'll tell you what, it's been a continuous process of talking to them and talking to them. Please don't leave. We want you here. You're valuable to us. And they're spending tons of extra money to stay there. And the guy finally comes in after some conversations with our zoning administrator. She okayed the sign. So I'm driving. I'm coming back from an event that was over here. And I'm driving by and I see the guys are standing out there kind of scratching their head. And they're going to get ready to put the sign up. So I pull in and Mr. Clement was walking down the road. I said, hey, you got a permit for that sign? Just teasing him. He whips around. He goes, God, am I glad you're here. I go, why? He says, well, we were told we could put the sign up, but it has to be 60 feet inside of the right-of-way. I said, what? I said, that's right in the building zone. Yeah. I go, put it up. And I pointed two spots to him. And they put the sign up. The point is that who is ever going to question that other than the one who said no? So you have to really pay attention to those little tiny things. So there's something that went on for a year and then still was a poke in the eye after they'd already started to dig it out. So pay real close attention to those first instances and make that the key element that brings them the rest of the way so they know that they're not going to run into crap after that.
Great. And they are under construction now.
Yes, they are.
Yes.
Thank you very much. I appreciate
it. Thank you. Sean O'Neill, the guru of planning and development in White Lake, and Ryan Dividock.
You are a liar.
Is the guts behind our One Stop Ready administratively. Thanks, Ryan. We're going to talk a little bit about the best practices, and the White Lake experience of going through them.
We're going to debunk the myth of expert, though, really quick before we start.
Expert? Okay.
Yeah, so thank you. Sean and I were talking just yesterday about this. You know, we don't profess to know everything about these best practices, and we know there's a lot of smart people in the room, so we want to make this an interesting and dynamic conversation. So feel free to jump in. And kind of explain how your community approaches these things as we go through them. So on your tables, everyone has a copy of the benchmark report. I want you to feel free to take that with you. And so the idea with the benchmark report here is that the community and the county liaisons meet over the course of the year to review these practices and procedures and to see if there's areas for improvement. Gives the community the opportunity to take a step back in their day-to-day operations and look at these things. It also gives us at the county the opportunity to learn from some of the unique ways communities are approaching these you know, these problem areas, and we can share that information with other communities that are involved in the program. So pre-application meetings, we've heard a lot about this already. It's really an applicant's opportunity to meet with relevant staff at a community and their consultants prior to formal review. Obviously, potential problem areas are discussed, and the timing of how things will go through the process is explained to the applicant, and at least you have a plan you know, formed at that point. The idea too is pre-application meetings at the county, we always, through this program, we stress that communities, you know, make that the availability, make people aware of the availability of these meetings, you know, both online and even through printed materials at your counter.
Yeah, I think I'm glad Matt Gibb left, because he was going to get through our whole presentation, which would have gotten you all out of here quicker, but then we just would waste a bunch of time. Some of the things we talk about, again, we're not going to split the atom here tonight or, you know, pull any rabbits out of the hat, but I think it's just good to get, you know, through this presentation and through all the presentations tonight, get the dialogue going, get the discussion going. We can all take something from one another from this room and from this whole program, which to me, for the township that I work in every day and represent at home, who are both who've both been participants, it's just really been about the dialogue and the communication. You know, whether you're at a township or a city, you know, your planning commission and your township board or your city council and your staff, they don't interact quite a bit. They may sporadically interact, but this gives everyone an opportunity to come and sit through these sessions and be on the same playing field and really get to know each other, get to know more about the process. I mean, as an elected official in Lyon Township, I don't know nearly as much about the day-to-day operation of that township as I do the one I work in every day. And so for me, being a part of this was really eye-opening, because I feel like as the planning director of the township, I was able to bring some of those things to my elected office at Lyon and vice versa. So it made me a more aware employee every day and made me a more aware elected official when I was sitting in judgment of projects. And so while I'm not kind of going off topic here, I just wanted at least kind of intro with some of that, because, you know, as Ryan said, we're not really going to teach you much that you don't already know. We're just going to maybe tell you maybe more about how we do things and how we approach things and try to provoke some thoughts. So as Ryan mentioned, you know, that pre-app meeting, which we've talked a lot about tonight, is really an opportunity to get your team together. And in White Lake, for example, I think before we started this program, we had a pretty good team, and we all understood what role we played. But until we all sat here together and kind of broke down some of those barriers, we didn't work quite as cooperatively and quite as proactively together. So once you're through this program, I think you'll probably find that if enough of your staff participates, hopefully you'll see that positive message kind of carry forward. And so when you're sitting as a team with a developer who's maybe never set foot in your community before, you know, you're going to kind of give them that kind of confidence that they're looking for, and that communication. And I think Matt used his fire chief as an example, or his fire marshal as an example. He sat there and didn't participate. And our experience now has been in White Lake that everyone looks forward to these meetings, because that's really your kind of tabletop review. You're going to sit down and knock the edges off of a plan before a more formal plan comes in the door. So you're saving the developer time, you're saving him money, you can tell him no quick, you can find out when he wants to put a shovel in the ground, he or she wants to put a shovel in the ground, and then you can get into the scheduling and laying out kind of your best case scenario, which is what every developer wants to know, big or small, mom or pop or Fortune 500, they want to know, what's this look like? What's this roadmap look like? And we all know that we've sat in those meetings and said, well, if you do this and if you do that and this meeting and that meeting, and you lay out the schedule and you get your calendar out and you go through it all, and a lot of it really depends on them hitting those benchmarks. And you give them the aggressive schedule, they don't want to have surprises, and then, you know, you kind of you know, carry that forward, you kind of amend it. When they miss a deadline because of some unforeseen hurdle, you've got to readjust, you've got to continue to calibrate. I mean, we're kind of like the quarterback of the development process, and so you call an audible. You know, you thought you were going to run this play, you've got to run something different. And you really have to stay on top of that, because that probably, from the, at least the perspective of a planner, is the most important thing I do, which is to keep all those trains running on time. Because if something gets derailed, I have to try to get it back on the track. I may not be the one who has the answer, but I have to bring all those people together, or else we don't stand a chance to move it along. We, and actually I'm going to advance to the next slide. More recently, we are, in the last year, we updated a website that really is no different from the one we paid to update, which is the successor. It was a terrible and embarrassing website that looked like a bunch of middle schoolers put it together. So this is the newest iteration. This is a meeting request form that's a fillable form online. Developer can come in and fill this out rather than fax it to us or put it in the mail or drive it to our office, and then we instantly, all the staff members get this in their email and can start to process a meeting request and set, you know, that in motion. And that seems, it's fairly new, but it seems to be well received. You know, we're doing a lot of things right, we feel, but we're doing a lot of things back in the horse and buggy days too, when we're trying to kind of identify and root those things out, and this process has been helpful in doing that. So I think you're next.
Yeah. Internet accessibility. Community's website should provide the necessary information for applicants to contact and conduct business with the community and to connect with outside agencies if they need to. Obviously, we're talking about having all of your applications for permits, fees, any incentives that you might offer for development available. All the information should be available online. Contact information, obviously, for the staff who are involved in the process, and also your elected officials too, is something that we really stress.
That fancy website I mentioned got hacked last night or this morning by ISIS, and there was some interesting video and music on it this morning, and I wish I was kidding. Not only did we have to take a look when he became a part of this program at our internet accessibility, but when Ryan asked me several weeks ago to participate in this after we got my presentation fee out of the way and I secured Panera Bread for everyone for dinner, I took some time and went back and looked at our internet, or I should say our website, and realized that for as long as it had been up, both my name and my senior planner's name were spelled wrong on the website. I don't know who put it up, but again, whatever we paid for it, we overpaid for it. And honestly, yeah, I'd been working there for like 2 months, and I had gone to the website to look for things, but I had never looked at the home page where my name was spelled wrong. It's embarrassing, but it's true, and I think that it's just an example of how you're in the middle of it every day, and you're working on things, you're putting out fires, but some of these simple things that are embarrassing, you know, may linger. So I would encourage you, yourselves, and you know, your staff to go on your website every day and pretend when you get a question and it takes you a second to navigate through, pretend you're the general public using your site, and go through other departments' pages too. I mean, the one thing about every website is, I mean, they're all different, and when you click to it, some are more intuitive, some are more user-friendly than others. I've looked at all three of the websites of the communities that are here tonight as participants, and they all have tons of information on them. They're all great websites. They're all very different. And so being different is fine, but make sure you're constantly, you know, and always encouraging people to give you feedback on that. Make sure all your, you know, folks have their names spelled correctly, have their extensions correctly listed if you're putting a phone tree on there. You know, all the links work to your email addresses, you know, your maps. Everyone, I think I looked at everyone's website and all of your maps were up there, your street index maps, your zoning maps, your master plan information. That should all be up there. When you amend those documents, don't forget to go back and change it on the website too. Your fee schedule, you go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, something we recommend to communities too, if you know or you have key development properties, you know, market those through your website. The other thing that as we've reviewed websites with the communities that have been involved in the program, we find kind of two examples. One, you know, one community may not have enough information, or one community has too much information, so try to find that middle ground. And I would also encourage you to ask, you know, how often is your website being reviewed, and really look at the usability of that site.
And I think fancy is nice, but fancy is not necessary. I mean, this is our link to, on our website, to, you know, anything, everything you might want. I can only screenshot so much, but I mean, we list out the utilities that are in our area, all the recreational opportunities that are kind of at the front of everyone's mind, school districts, and I didn't mean to cut you county guys off, but you know, you barely made the bottom of the page here. You know, obviously everything there is hyperlinked. There's phone numbers if you don't wanna, you know, use the hyperlink. So I mean, it's just that simple. That's pretty basic, but pretty clear to understand.
I just, last week was in a seminar with some businesses and site selectors, and they were talking about some communities that don't have the phone numbers or the contact in the development arena, It was, send us an email, we'll respond to you within 24 hours. They said that's an immediate, we're not gonna do that. You know, it's gotta be staff and a phone number, heck with the internet. We're all jammed with emails. They would like the information that they're looking for to be on the website, but if not, or there's a question about something, they wanna go right to the individual.
Proactive project tracking ensures that the applicant is aware of submission requirements and key decision dates. And what we're really talking about here is tracking from application to occupancy in a consistent and retrievable form. We're also looking to see if, does the community hold regular meetings to review current projects? After a project is completed, are there methods in place to identify and address any unresolved issues as well?
We're pretty small at White Lake and small staff. There aren't generally two people that do the same job in any department. So there are only a handful of people that we would have to meet with on a regular basis. So that's usually my job, is to go and contact them as a project's moving through and make sure everything's, you know, kind of going ahead on schedule and on time, and, you know, really being proactive. The developers, you know, I know this is being videotaped, but you know, some of them you have to hold their hand like a five-year-old in traffic. And you know as soon as you have the first meeting with them if it's going to go that way or not. There are some that are more savvy than others, but they're all check writers, and so they all need to, you know, garner as much attention as you can possibly give them in order to make their project, you know, move ahead. You know, we use BSNA and Laserfish to track projects. We just got BSNA coming out of the Stone Age. We had an old Canadian program that nobody liked, and we kept putting money into it, and no one knew why, and so we spent a bunch of money changing gears. And late last year brought BSNA in, and we have a planning, zoning, and engineering module that's, we're just starting to get up and running to help us track projects, but, you know, and so we're not fully integrated yet, but we're moving in that direction, which has been helpful. You know, and we talk about project tracking through the end, kind of cradle to grave, then at the end, you know, we're making sure that everybody's on the same page when a project's wrapping up, and they're getting ready to close construction and open for business, and, you know, we start punching projects out a month in advance, because we don't want to take their money to bond, we don't want to hold their money, we want them done and on doing what they're here to do in town, you know, sell tractors or, you know, sell hamburgers or whatever it is. So we try to be proactive and get them to get a punch list early, get with all of our departments out in the field and meet as often as we need to kind of sort through all the issues. You know, one of my favorite tracking devices is an ancient tool that some of you may recognize. This really is the board in my less than fancy office. So, you know, this works too. I mean, you know, everybody's so focused on technology that they're embarrassed to sometimes admit in front of a bunch of people that they use stuff like this, but that's fine too. Whatever gets the job done, and obviously we're all different in our communities and have different ways of approaching things, but yeah, a little ancient tracking never hurts.
Clear and efficient permitting process. It really, a customer service approach is the key to the permitting and inspection process. Obviously, we're looking to see that permits and inspections are processed in a timely manner, but also is staff empowered to resolve any customer complaints? Does your community hold pre-construction and development review meetings with applicants to ensure that they understand what, you know, necessary permits, fees, and inspections are necessary?
So I'm not a big quote person. It get a little cheesy, but you know, came across this one a while back. And I think that, you know, empowerment is generally education and training for your staff. And, you know, the quote at the bottom of this page, jumping to the bottom, is the only thing worse than training employees and losing them is not training them and keeping them. You know, in every office setting, whether you're doing what we do or somewhere else, there's always kind of that one, maybe, I'm not going to say bad apple, but I said bad apple, you know, that kind of brings everybody down and does things this way because it's the way that it's always been done, and they don't want to come out of their comfort zone and change. I mean, I think that, you know, Rick's laughing because he talked about somebody who worked at the township for 73 years or something and, you know, didn't want to change. And that's just human nature, I guess. But I think kind of pushing them and encouraging them and providing those opportunities helps them be a better employee and makes your operation function that much better. So we've talked about, you know, permit applications and processing things in a timely manner. You know, we can now receive permit inspection requests via our new website, which has been helpful. We used to have to call and talk to a human being or call call and leave a message, and that, that worked, but it wasn't necessarily efficient. Now all of our inspectors use tablets and dock their tablets every night, and everything's uploaded to the system or downloaded, whichever way it's loaded. And, you know, these inspectors who are well along in their careers absolutely said, we don't want anything to do with this. And we said, well, as long as you're working here, you're going to have to, you know, figure out how you're going to, you know, cooperate with us and get on board. And, you know, that's a top-down kind of thing. I mean, the leadership said, we're going to start using the same, you know, program, and it's going to trickle down. And some folks who didn't know how to turn the tablet on are now some of the people who are using them the most and most happy with what they do for them every day. So it's contagious and in a good way. So I think making sure that you're being proactive in getting, you know, implementing some of this technology, turning requests around quickly, you know, setting up pre-construction meetings toward the end of a project is something that we really try to do rather than pride ourselves on being able to tell someone that we can have a meeting and have everybody there before they can. And I think that's the same way through a approval process. When they say, how quickly can we get approval? And we say, how quickly can you get us plans? We can turn them around a lot quicker than you can turn them around. And, you know, we take great pride in that. And same thing with our inspection or pre-construction process. I mean, it's sort of a race, and the team is kind of all on board with trying to do it as quick as they can and shock the applicant with how quickly our little township with our, you know, one horse looking township hall can, you know, turn something on its ear and move it along. So yeah, if you haven't seen White Lake Township Hall, you haven't missed much. It's green, it's hideous, but the roof doesn't leak usually.
The fifth best practice of business and community input, we're looking to see if methods are in place to gather input from businesses and other stakeholders to identify potential problems and gather suggestions.
Yeah, I guess this isn't a quote, and I don't know, verbal punching bag's inappropriate, but I thought this was kind of funny. I work in customer service, so by all means, please use me as a verbal punching bag. It makes me more likely to do what you want when you scream your request at me. You know, usually our feedback's positive, but of course not always. And generally when you're gonna get your most honest feedback is not when the person you're getting the feedback from is really needing you to perform some task for them. It's usually after the fact when they can reflect back on the process and say, you know, there were a couple bumps in the road, but, you know, by and large, this is a pretty good process, and I've developed in a lot of communities, and these are the things that you guys really do well, and these are a couple of things you need to work on. And that's something that may be hard to hear, but it's something that you need. It's something you need to seek if you're not already, if you're not getting enough of it, because I would rather know now, today, what I'm not doing well enough and what the team isn't doing well enough so I can not repeat those mistakes, because it's been mentioned, you know, it's easy to get a bad reputation, and it's really hard to get a good reputation. So, Calfani.
Yeah, no, so I was just going to say for those communities that aren't already engaged in it, business retention calls are a great way to get this information, because a lot of times once a business goes through the process, they've already invested so much money, they're not going to just stop and say, well, you know, I don't like doing business here, I'm going to go somewhere else. But they also aren't necessarily going to be nice enough to come back and say, you know, you really made this difficult for me. But if you reach out to them and ask, they will be surprisingly honest about how much they enjoyed or did not enjoy the process. And then you get two things out of that. One, if they didn't enjoy the process, you learn, and you can fix the process for the next person. But two, you can also even change their perception of you by the fact that you reached out to them. And you can end up keeping them there longer term and getting them to actually invest more in their property.
Yeah, I think what I've enjoyed is having, after projects end, and I had a developer 2 days ago in my office who developed a coal store that's been in White Lake, White Lake for a dozen years. He just stops in once in a while. And I know I was working for the township, but my predecessor was in my job at the time, and I know there were some serious bumps in the road because I heard a lot of yelling outside of what is now my office when it wasn't my office. And, you know, keeping those relationships up, and I think it's a great point, you know, not every developer in town, you know, has a face, let's say. You know, if some corporate group comes in and throws up a Taco Bell and they're on to the next one, you may never see them, but it's those maybe more local or regional developers that come calling once in a while. I think it's important to follow up with them. Because they're going to do more projects, and they're going to be as you build those relationships, brutally honest with you, and that's what you need. I mean, it's great to hear how wonderful you are and how sweet you are, mm-hmm. but we all think that of ourselves anyway. So we need to hear the just the bitter truth. You know, what can we do better? And I think that that's a good point. And I probably need to do more of it, which is to get on the phone and say, what did you think? You know,
just a question for California and Farmington Hills. So I think that's the best way, is person to person, but you can't conceivably get back out with all projects. So do you routinely survey, you know, through Survey Monkey or hard copy? Do any communities do that on other projects?
We don't routinely do a survey like that, but what we have started doing this year is having basically seminars where we invite all of the business community to come for an hour, and we talk about all of the different tools that are available, because there are so many things that businesses aren't using, and we can't get out face-to-face with every business to do a retention call to say, hey, how are things going? But we can highlight some of the things, and we're also targeting those to segments. So the first one that we did, we targeted to retail segments, the mom and pop smaller ones. We're doing another one in August, I wanna say, that's targeted to startups, and then we'll do another one at the end of the year that will be targeted to more manufacturing, industrial, and that's another way to just get the aggregated feedback.
We don't use enough social media, I think, in most people's opinion in White Lake, but the supervisor's office is kind of our official liaison. Obviously, all department heads can speak to the press or represent at least their little piece of our world when asked, but you know, our Parks and Rec group, which is under planning, under our umbrella, we have a Facebook page, but we don't really participate enough in social media, no Facebook, no Twitter. We have a website. We're kind of lagging in that. I think people of all generations kind of expect that everyone's kind of going that way, and they look for it. So it's funny when someone my grandpa's age asked me why we don't have a Twitter account. I'm sorry, I don't know.
I would say at a minimum, all the communities at least are using email or a newsletter to try to communicate with businesses. And my question to you is, you know, once you get that feedback, are you using it to try to improve that process?
Be a good idea also, I mean, in order to retain our businesses, I like your idea of asking them, you know, to talk to us and ask, you know, what have we done right, you know, how can we improve? But would it also be a good idea to, I guess, recognize those that have been there for a long time? You know, as government officials, it's very hard, we need to stay neutral. And so sometimes, you know, I don't put businesses on our website because I don't want somebody to think that, you know, we're only recommending this one business. And that's one of the hard things that I have sometimes. But would it be a good idea to maybe, you know, have some sort of mechanism where we recognize the business that's been there for 20 years or 50 years or something like that?
In Lyon Township, where I live, we have a DDA, and they do a very nice job. And Tina Archer, who's our administrator, does a very nice job of things like that. We do ribbon cuttings, but we also recognize businesses that have been around for a while. We don't have a DDA in White Lake. We don't have really a strong business association. We have, you know, we're partnering with our neighbors to the east and to the west. Waterford is a very strong business association, and Highland has a business association. It used to be High White. I don't know if that's still what they call it, but you know, it's kind of going through some changes, and we're trying to work together, and we've got great neighbors, which is helpful in, you know, attracting and retaining businesses and kind of working together. But I think that's pretty critical. And Kalpana, you've got some experience
in
this.
Well, yeah, so I would say one thing that we do, which is we have a cable show. And so we will pick a business topic and get a local business to come and talk about that topic. And it does two things. One, it promotes that business. But two, it also is something that other businesses can learn from. So the next one that we have coming up will actually be talking about HR. And so we have an HR firm that will talk about all the things that they do, but we're also gonna talk about, you know, when do you outsource your HR? When do you think about bringing it back in-house? And you know, what are all of the different legal ramifications that you have to go through? So the firm will get, you know, some notoriety, but also small businesses out there will say, oh, you know, I've been having this problem and I haven't thought about different ways to solve it. So that's a way that you can promote businesses without being feeling like you are promoting one business over another, because anybody can say, hey, I'd like to do a show with you. And then you just write the script around what's going to help everyone.
Rick, yeah.
And Kyle, something that we've kind of done a little differently than other communities is that the business association we're talking about is actually Highland White Lake Business Association. And during the recession, it had a little bit of difficulty, you know, kind of almost tanked. And because it's a 501c3 and it does community, it's there for the community, we actually authorize them to be in one of our buildings so that they're right there working with our art council, they're working with our DDA, they're all in the same spot. The other thing that we've done is the clerk, the treasurer, and myself are all members of that business association. So what happens is we go to the meetings, we go to the lunches, we had one today, and support that business organization. So what happens is we don't necessarily have to do it and play favorites, but the fact that they know that we're part of that organization makes a big difference on how they look at what the government's there for and what it can help them do. So I think by having that direct relationship with a business organization and the businesses themselves, it supports them feeling more comfortable with where they're at in our community and what they can expect from us. So I think that's something that I've never seen the other communities do that. You know, they're always kind of afraid to be there and don't want to get out of that. But that's one way that, you know, you can do it, is to literally have the key people in your community as part of the business association.
I like having
them in the
building.
I think it's okay, though, to maybe in somewhere on the website, the data category, you can list some of your major businesses, you know, because that would be helpful to know. Or a resident of the community or someone looking. Ideally without exact employment numbers, because, you know, those change all the time. Maybe a range, but, you know, top 10, I think we have on our website, top 10, top 15, top 20 employers. And that changes a little bit, but we find that to be very useful in communicating. Yeah, you don't get the small businesses on there. They're very important. We try to get out there for ribbon cuttings or 5-year anniversary or 10-year anniversary, something like that, usually with a chamber. And just thank them, you know. A thank you goes a long, long way. Just simple stuff.
Finally, the green sheet that's in the one of the last sheets in the benchmark report is a self-evaluation, customer service, and communication. This section, really, the intention here is to engage the community leadership, and we asked the chief elected official to review this portion of the benchmark and involve their elected and appointed officials and come to consensus on all of these items here. How are they doing in terms of their planning and zoning permitting process? How do they regularly review their ordinance policies and procedures? A lot of times we hear, really the biggest thing I can point to of projects getting derailed or what we hear from communities is it really comes down to communication. We've already heard that tonight. And that's why through this program we really stress having that annual joint meeting in communities where you're bringing all of your boards, councils, planning commission, zoning board, all of you guys, DDA together, to really understand what's your philosophy in your community, what's your vision, you know, get everybody on that same page in terms of moving in a direction, can really really solve a lot of those problems. Finally, I just want to point out the last sheet in here is the planning and zoning decision guide. And it's a checklist for elected and appointed officials and staff to assist them in understanding their role in the economic development process. So we encourage you to use this with any new people coming into your community that are working in your community to really give them a sense of what their role and understanding of it is. So that covers the benchmark report, and we are complete done here tonight. But I do want to point out we did change the third academy class date, which is now October 18th. Implementation of best practices focuses on the pre-application process.
And that's still at 8:00?
No, all three academy sessions are in the evenings on Wednesdays. So that October 18th is a Wednesday evening. It would be at the same time, 6:30, if the program would start. And thanks everyone for coming.
Let's give these two gentlemen a round of applause. We actually used to have four academy sessions, and so we kind of boiled it down to three. This one's a little bit longer, until 9:00. The next one, 8:30, the investor session. I think we've got our investors lined up, but I'm not positive, so I won't mention who they are. But it's really interactive, and it's one of the highlights. As well as the implementation of best practices, we'll do a mock pre-application with one of our communities and a real project. Last year we had the entire Orient Township team, and it was a lot of fun with building and fire and planning and Chris Barnett, Township Supervisor. It was really pretty cool. So those next two are really good. Hopefully you can come and spread the word. Anyone that's got anything to do with development in your community, we'd love to have them here. Thanks to Gary and to Rick.
Thanks,
I'm glad the Highland House is still going on. Yeah. Bread sticks.
Absolutely.
So everyone have a great evening and a July 4th. Thank you.
Yeah.